Before I start, I request all the students to kindly switch on their camera and be on mute mode. All are requested to post their queries with your name in the chat box to our academic head, Dr. Anubhav Verma. Dignitaries are scheduled to speak for 20 minutes each. As quoted by our Honorable Prime Minister, Shri Narendra Modi ji, that National Education Policy 2020 is focused on how to think rather than what to think. With this vision for National Education Policy, Army Institute of Management and Technology, Greater Noida, has organized this webinar on NEP 2020 Impact on Management Education. On behalf of Army Institute of Management and Technology, Greater Noida, I, Rahul Verma, Assistant Professor, welcome all the dignitaries, eminent speakers, Director, Principal, and Registrar of AIE, ACMS, AIL, ACN, faculty members, all the participants, and my dear students to this webinar on NEP 2020. Before we start the program, it is customary to invoke the blessings of Ma Saraswati. So let's start with lighting of lamp and Saraswati Vandana.
ब्रह्माच्युत शंकर प्रपतिभिः देवैः सदा वन्दिता सा मां पातु सरस्वती भगवती निःशेषजाय शुक्ला ब्रह्मविता रसार परमा आद्यां जगद्व्यापिनीं वीणा पुस्तकधारिणीं अभयदा जाड्यान्धकारापहा हस्ते स्फाटिकमालिकां विदधतीं पद्मासने परमेश्वरीं भगवतीं बुद्धिप्रदां शारदां
थैंक यू पंकज नाउ आई वुड लाइक टू इनवाइट आवर डायरेक्टर सर कॉमोडोर डॉक्टर विवेक चावला फॉर डिलीवरिंग द इंट्रोडक्टरी वेलकम स्पीच सर
Good afternoon to everybody. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Respected General Alok Kakkar, Chief of Staff and Chairman, Army Institute of Management and Technology, BGS, Brigadier Naveen Goyal, Deputy Chairman, AIMT, the directors and principals of the Army College of Medical Sciences, Army Institute of Education, Army Institute of Law, and Army College of Nursing, Professor Sasmit Patra, Honorable Member of Parliament, Rajya Sabha, Professor Raj Singh, Vice Chancellor, Jain University, Professor Pankaj Gupta, Dean O.P. Jindal, Global University, Professor Anil Kumar Saini, Dean, University School of Management Studies, Guru Gobind Singh, Indraprastha University, Professor Irfan Rizvi, Professor of Leadership and Change Management, International Management Institute, New Delhi. Colonel Bhatti, Director of the Army Welfare Education Society, Western Command. Colonel Vivek Jhala, Staff Officer Colleges, Headquarters, Delhi Area. Registrars of all the Army Colleges under Headquarters, Western Command. AIMT alumni, distinguished dignitaries, faculty and students of AIMT, ladies and gentlemen. Good afternoon. On behalf of our Chairman and Management Committee, AIMT, it is a pleasure and a privilege to welcome you all to this online webinar on the National Education Policy 2020 being organized by the Army Institute of Management and Technology, Greater Noida. A very warm and special welcome to our panelists, Professor Sasmit Patra, Professor Raj Singh, Professor Anil Kumar Saini, Professor Pankaj Gupta, and Professor Irfan Rizvi. A special welcome also to the directors, principals, and registrars of all the Army colleges under the headquarters Western Command. Before I proceed ahead, I would like to give you all a brief insight into AIMT. The Army Institute of Management and Technology, Greater Noida, was established by the Army Welfare Education Society in 2004 to provide quality management education to the wards of Army personnel. The forerunner of AIMT was the Faculty of Management Studies, Jabalpur, which was established in 1995 and later on took on the avatar of AIMT Greater Noida. AIMT is governed by the Army Welfare Education Society, which is operating 12 Army colleges encompassing medicine, engineering, law, dental, fashion design, hospitality management, and nursing. The AWS also governs over 140 Army schools spread over the length and breadth of our country. AIMT is affiliated to the Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University, Dwarka, New Delhi, and conducts 2-year full-time MBA program in marketing, finance, human resources, operations management, information technology, and international business for the wards of Army personnel. In 2019, AIMT has commenced the BBA program, and presently we have 2 batches of BBA in progress. AIMT is located in the Knowledge Hub of Greater Noida and has a self-contained sprawling campus spread over 15 acres. The campus is fully residential with IT-enabled classrooms, separate hostel for boys and girls, faculty residences, gymnasium, yoga lawns, and all facilities for sports and games. In addition, the campus is fully Wi-Fi enabled with standby generators for power backup. AIMT is NAC accredited, ISO 9001:2015 certified. It is recognized by the All India Council of Technical Education, and it has been graded A by the Joint Assessment Council of Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University. AIMT is also having Memorandum of Understanding with various foreign and Indian colleges for academic exchange. Coming now to the online webinar on the National Education Policy 2020. Being an affiliated college of Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University, AIMT is exploring ways of harnessing the full potential of the NEP for the growth, the development, and the furtherance of our institute in the years ahead. We are also looking to explore options for the introduction of new and innovative courses for the students so as to ensure holistic development and to meet the goals envisaged in the NEP. Here, I would like to take a leaf from the quote by Ralph Wolff, president of the World Future Society, who said, "We are responsible for preparing our students to address problems we cannot foresee with knowledge that has not yet been developed, using technology that has not yet been invented. Or in other words, the problems we have cannot be solved at the same level of thinking at which we created them." The deliberations in the webinar will provide actionable food for thought in forging the way ahead. I am sanguine that the presence of a galaxy of academic luminaries at this forum will enlighten all of us with regard to the important and noteworthy aspects of the NEP and would act as a guiding force for AIMT. The itinerary for the webinar is already known, but I will just briefly cover it. We will have the inaugural address by Brigadier Naveen Goyal after this. Thereafter, we have the address by the chief guest, Professor Dr. Raj Singh, Vice Chancellor. By Professor Dr. Anil Kumar Saini, Dean of the University School of Management Studies, Indraprastha University. Then we have the keynote address by Professor Dr. Pankaj Gupta, Dean, OP Jindal, Global University. This will be followed by the thematic address by Professor Dr. Irfan Rizvi, Professor IMI. And thereafter, we have the address by the guest of honor, Dr. Sashmit Patra, the Honorable Member of Parliament. On behalf of the management of AIMT, I once again extend a very warm and hearty welcome to each one of you and look forward to your active participation in the webinar. Thank you. Jai Hind.
Thank you, sir. Now, I would like to invite Brigadier Naveen Kumar Goyal, BGS, headquartered Delhi area, for the inaugural address. A brief profile of Brigadier Naveen Kumar Goyal. Brigadier Naveen Kumar Goyal was commissioned into the elite 3rd Battalion of the 1st Gorkha Rifles, also called PVC Pulton, on 13 June 1987, and had the honor to command the same. An alumnus of National Defense Academy, Khadakwasla, the officer is a postgraduate from Defense Service Staff College, Wellington. The officer also holds a master's degree in Business Administration Finance, where he has majored in international business from Bhopal University. He has topped the MBA class of 2011-13 and was awarded the University Topper Trophy. An erudite personality, the officer is also an advanced diploma holder in the Russian language. I invite once again Brigadier Naveen Kumar Goyal, sir.
Dr. Sasmit Patra, Member of Parliament, Rajya Sabha, Professor Dr. Raj Singh, Vice Chancellor, Jain University, Professor Dr. Anil Kumar Jaini, Dean, USMS, Guru Gobind Singh, Indraprastha University, Professor Dr. Pankaj Gupta, Dean, O.P. Jindal Global University, Professor Dr. Irfan Rizvi, Professor IMI New Delhi, Commodore Dr. Vivek Chawla, Director AIMT, esteemed dignitaries, distinguished speakers, academia, AIMT alumni, faculty of AIMT, and dearest of all the students. It is my pleasant duty to welcome all of you for the webinar on the theme National Education Policy 2020, Impact on Management Education at Army Institute of Management and Technology, Greater Noida. The Union Cabinet approved a new education policy, that is the National Education Policy 2020, on July 29, 2020, after a gap of 34 years. The National Education Policy 2020 is meant to provide an overarching vision and comprehensive framework for both school and higher education across the country. It is only a policy, not a law, and the implementation of its proposals depends on further regulations by both the states and the center, as education is a concurrent subject. The NEP proposes to change the school curricular structure from the current 10 plus 2, that is classes 1 to 10 of general education, followed by 2 years of higher secondary school with specialized subjects, with a 5 plus 3 plus 3 structure, bringing children from the ages 3 to 5 years within the formal education system for the first time, and ensuring curricular continuity in the last 4 years. A mission for foundational literacy and numeracy, free breakfast being added to free lunches in government schools, vocational education along with internships from class 6, and proposed redesign of the board examinations are some of the major initiatives for the school education. For higher education, a new umbrella regulator has been proposed with separate verticals for regulation, standard setting, accreditation, and funding. It'll absorb arts and science, technical and teacher education into its fold, replacing several existing regulatory bodies, and also ensure a level playing field for public and private players. Top foreign universities will be allowed to set up campuses in India. The NEP also recommends sweeping changes for the faculty engagement and development, including research activities, freedom to design their own curricular and pedagogical approaches within the approved framework, rewarding of the excellence by incentives, promotions, and rewards, etc. For schools, the biggest change will be introduction of the 360 degree learning, freedom to choose subjects across the spectrum, the introduction of four-year undergraduate degrees with options for entry and exit at various stages, and a credit transfer system. In order to understand the implications of the national education policy in management education and its implementation, this particular webinar is being organized by the Army Institute of Management and Technology. Ladies and gentlemen, without taking much of your time, I request the eminent speakers to start the deliberations. We are deeply honored to welcome you all once again. Happy learning. Jai Hind.
Thank you, sir. Now, I would like to invite our chief guest of the event, Professor Raj Singh, Vice Chancellor, Jain University, for addressing the audience. A brief profile of Professor Singh. Professor Raj Singh is a professional with sound experience of academic leadership, administration, system development, team management, governance, and institution building. Sir has a unique leadership style that creates positive environment and brings out the best in the team for achieving organizational goals, and is the one who is hands-on, can visualize the future, articulates it in a lucid manner, and ensures implementation. Sir has started his career from Indian Air Force in 1981. Thereafter, he joined academia as head in ICFAI group of IBS, and thereafter he has been into various positions of vice chancellors and pro vice chancellors with various universities. Some of those are Amity, Shobhit University, GT Goenka University. Sir has also been a vice co-chair at SOCHM Karnataka chapter. As far as education qualification is concerned, sir is a doctoral degree holder in financial strategy from Maharshi Dayanand University and a CFA from ICFAI. As far as sir volunteer experience is concerned, sir is the board member at Ranking Framework of SAR and Chairman Expert Committee National Board of Accreditation, that is NBA. So I once again invite our chief guest, Professor Raj Singh, for the chief guest address.
Thank you. Good afternoon, namaskar, adab, sat sri akal. It's a pleasure for me to join from this beautiful city, Bangalore, and I convey my greetings on behalf of entire Jain University fraternity, consisting of 23,000 students in university and 83,000 in the groups, including schools. Thank you for inviting me to this deliberations on national education policy, I think, which has been one of the most widely discussed topics in the last 1 year. My distinguished co-panelists and speakers, Honorable Director, Brigadier Saab, who just addressed, all the faculty members, students, delegates, ladies and gentlemen. Last year, on 29th of July, when national education policy was announced by the government of India, Ministry of Education now, earlier it used to be MHRD, it appeared to me that it had connived with COVID-19, because it was so timely in terms of it being announced, when the acceptability level for change, I think, was the highest ever in the history of higher education. You would recall that when the lockdown was imposed, previous evening, we as professors, as we are known, we vehemently opposed certain teaching learning methods, certain concepts, and said we are fine without it. But I think next day morning when we woke up, we all were more than willing to accept it. I think that has been the level of acceptability when this policy was announced. It has many clauses touching almost every aspect of higher education landscape, as it touches the aspects of school education. Very timely and indeed a forward-looking policy to transform India's higher education landscape completely and make it globally competitive. While I say this, this policy quite resembles with what happened in Europe 20 years ago. And the process started 1998 with Bologna Declaration and ended with European recommendations in 2006. And when I went through both the policies, which was announced in India last year, there were striking similarities. And the good news is that in 2010, when European recommendations were reviewed, I think the effectiveness was quite high. So it was successfully implemented and the benefits were there for all of us to see. And if we implement sincerely in a planned manner, I see no reason why the India's new national education policy be a success. It has to be made success because I think we've been tired of hearing that Indian higher education has been lagging behind in the global arena. And therefore this blot has to go. We have heard it more than I think a fair share of what we deserve. And while I'll discuss all the provisions and how do we go about it, and particularly with reference to management education, I need to emphasize that the need for higher education is to prepare our graduates for a growing gig economy. You will agree with me that after a few years, maybe 5 to 10 years, more and more, we will be having lesser and lesser permanent jobs. And we will have more freelancing, more specialist kind of job. And one of the outcomes or one of the consequences of this will be that we have to be the best in the field we are, or to be the best in whatever we do. And then we have to remain relevant on an ongoing basis. The career trajectories of the graduates now onwards will be predicted by certain applications which are based on metadata, AI, and machine learning tools. You may be aware that Google has already announced that they don't need degrees. If you are 10 plus 2 qualified, it's fine with them. And they predict your career trajectory for next 10 years and will exactly tell you, depending on which trajectory you want to be, what skills need to be acquired at what time, and they will facilitate that. 2 years ago, Forbes magazine gave this stunning data and said that the children who entered schools in 2016, when they graduate and go to corporate world, 65% of the jobs they will be working on do not exist today. As was mentioned by the director, we will have to use knowledge which doesn't exist today. We'll have to use technology which has not been developed so far. And we have to prepare our graduates for the jobs which do not exist today. So I think the biggest question in front of all of us is that which job, what skill set we should prepare our students for. And therefore the focus has clearly shifted to learnability rather than teaching them these skills and making them job ready. And learnability ensures that they will keep on themselves, upgrading themselves on an ongoing basis in an auto mode. We will have to get used to human-machine interface kind of environment. Teachers have started competing with themselves. Every Zoom class or Google Meet, or Microsoft Meeting class or Google Meet class is recorded. And next time I don't need you. And therefore, when I deliver next lecture on same or similar topic, I have to be significantly different with new perspectives, with new examples, new applications, because redundancy is going to only increase. As far as students are concerned, I think they have greater responsibility to shoulder. It's no more somebody checking you whether you're in the class or not, whether you're attentive or not. You have to be attentive behind the scene. Whether you are switching on the camera or not, it's entirely your responsibility. And it seems to me, Khalil Gibran's concept of teacher-student definition is truly being implemented today, where he said that the onus of learning has to be on the student, the best described relationship. When he said that if he is indeed wise, he will not let you enter the house of wisdom. He would rather lead you to the threshold of your own mind. An astronomer can speak to you about his understanding of space, but he cannot give you the understanding of space. And he says that a musician can sing to the rhythm that's available in all space, but he cannot give you the ears that arrest the rhythm, nor the voice that echoes it. I think that relationship has to be characterized in true sense, which he, I think, articulated many, many decades ago. But all said and done, implementation is the key. A document on paper may be excellent, but it remains excellent on the paper And therefore, implementation has been the key. And believe me, in India, that's my main concern, because historically, if you look at, there has been a huge gap between policy making and implementation, as all of us must have experienced. But as I said initially, the positive side of it, the ray of hope is that the willingness to change is all-time high in the history of higher education. I won't be wrong that if I look at next 5 to 6 years, the changes in education, and particularly in higher education, they'll be pulled by national education policy directives or the proposals. It will be pushed by the consequences of COVID-19, which is yet to come to an end, and its impact may linger over next one decade or so. But I think in between, like an engine, the facilitation process will be done by the advancements of technology, particularly Industry 4.0, coexisting with 3.0 and 5.0. So NEP will provide the pull, COVID will push it, and technology will enable the way we move in higher education over the next 5 to 6 years. If I look at the provisions of national education policy, even though from clause 10 to clause 24, it becomes almost 15. But if I have to put in summary, the major provisions are as follows. Number one, it has proposed multidisciplinary large institutions in the form of research universities, teaching universities, and autonomous colleges, which will grant degrees. No hard separations in terms of disciplines and also in terms of type of education. As was highlighted, that B.Ed and vocational education have to be part of the mainstream campuses. And so is the case of, regular online distance learning, vocational type of education has to be without any separation. They have to come closer. The second provision talks about the flexibility of choices in an outcome-based education environment. As you're aware, academic bank of credit, a most disruptive concept I have come across, is already in the draft stage and very soon will become a reality, and this will challenge each one of us, leading to a different requirement of engagement with the community, with the society, with industry, and also field-based kind of activities by the student. Education will truly become holistic. The third major provision is high-quality research and innovation. I think this is going to be the mainstay, wherein in the olden days, whatever research we did was only academic research, and that's it. It keeps lying in our shelves in the form of dissertations and theses, and nothing happened after that. Internationalization of higher education is the next major focus area, and technology and integration leading to specialization in technology, as well as, harnessing technology to move towards the target GR of 50% by 2030, 2035. In different sources, but policy document says 2030, which is a very, very ambitious target. We cannot achieve it without leveraging technology. A lot has been talked about the governance, that both private and public sector will be at the same footing in terms of autonomy of functioning, in terms of appointing senior positions. The governing bodies will be enjoying that autonomy. Language, art, culture, values, which we inherit from Indian heritage and culture, will become integral part. And that, of course, will be supported by availability of faculty and resources of world-class quality. Equity, inclusivity, and access to quality education. I think the quality which was not there in the earlier provisions had been added. So no matter in what way you access education, quality has to be ascertained. And finally, the regulation part of it, as was pointed out earlier, for autonomous, that is regulation, standard setting, accreditation, and funding have been made autonomous. But it also talks about light but tight control. In case of violations, the consequences could be severe, as has not been done in the past. If you look at the technological advancements, we moved from Industrial Revolution 1 to 4, in fact, 5th has set in. So while I'll not talk about first three, as we all have been studying for very, very long, Industry 4.0, as it is called, is significantly different in the sense that earlier industrial revolutions were defined vertically with the sources of energy and means of communication. 4.0 cuts across these vertical definitions, and it resembles convergence of physical, biological, and digital worlds, and makes it very, very complicated. And it is because of fourth industrial revolution we have seen the growth, which is difficult to assess and difficult to understand. It has completely revolutionized the way we work, the way we study, the way we deliver various services and goods, and the way we ensure quality. The total governance has been changed. Fifth industrial revolution is like a breather, it's a fresh air kind of things, which says that we cannot surrender to technology, and therefore ethics and heart and emotions have to be taken care of. And I understand, as I read more about sixth and seventh, they will be predicting human behavior and human emotions many, many years from now. And that's going to make things much more difficult for all of us. So if I look at next 10 years, our education will be defined by changes like flying taxis and hyperloop transportation system, artificial intelligence and robots working as companions for human beings. Don't be surprised that after a few years, in a project team, a robot is sitting across the table and discussing with you. So we need to get used to this. Mobiles, which are smart, may well become dumb once again. And rest of the functions being performed on cloud. Instead of World Wide Web, we're likely to have planet internet across planets. Drones will be commonly used to deliver services goods. I think that's going to be not only for the delivery, but also performing tasks like for farmers. If you want to measure the soil structure in the land which you're cultivating, instead of taking help of multi-billion dollar satellites, these small instruments will be very, very handy. 3D printing is going to print cities. As per one of the estimates, by 2030, Dubai will have 50% of construction through 3D printed modules. You know that in London, one of the underground stations is completely made of prefab 3D printed blocks. So 3D printing is going to revolutionize. Mission to Mars will redefine tourism. Hospitals at home, because less and less you'll be required to travel to the hospitals to get medical treatment. When bandwidth is available, doctors sitting in one part of the world will be performing a surgery in another part of the world with the help of very, very competent and qualified technical staff. Joy of shopping. Now, all said and done, one of the major impact on education has to be, it has to be a creative learning process in view of all the changes. Atmanirbhar Bharat kind of initiatives by Government of India present a unique opportunity for education institutions to relook at the way they impart education. I'll give you some examples as I go along. The impact on state universities, which was one specific question asked to me of national education policy, according to me, will be as follows. They'll have to do away with affiliated college system. I think the limit has been prescribed 2034, 2035, because that much of time they require in terms of accrediting all these institutions and make them autonomous that they can award their own degrees. Now, this has major, major implications for affiliating state universities or the technical universities which affiliate colleges. It'll need a complete mindset change. Believe me, we can't fathom enough what kind of change is required. But to shift from managing an affiliated college system to rethink, redesign, and relaunch the programs which they're currently offering, if they have to compete in the new multidisciplinary university environment. These universities will have to undertake innovative course design, teaching learning methods to be implemented, and revolutionary evaluation reforms. You will agree with me that the current evaluation system is something which has not served the purpose, and therefore we need to completely relook at it. But one of the most important recommendations in terms of teaching learning process and research will be that research has to be extended to innovation and application to solve real life problems. I think this is the mandate given to all the academic institutions by the community, by the industry, by the society. The other day, one of my colleagues asked me that why research funding mostly comes from government in India and why not from the industry, and asked a question that why should industry fund you? Have you ever provided a viable solution to any of their problems? And there was silence, and the answer was given. These universities will have to develop new capabilities, because the affiliated college faculty and staff and the management will not be there with them. They'll have to look inward and develop those competencies. you know what referring to, having experience of even running affiliated colleges as a part of our group. So this message is very, very clear. There's some of the changes, and therefore they have to develop, I think, alternative revenue streams to be sustainable. Most impacted sector will be, I think, the state universities, which have been affiliating colleges and affiliating college concept clearly been asked to go away. I think it's a very bold statement of national education policy, which say that out of 40,000 colleges, about 1,000 universities, and many autonomous institutions and institutions of eminence. So if I look at all these taken together, about 50,000, what will remain is about 15 to 20,000. So I think a consolidation, a restructuring, which is unimaginable, is going to take place. And therefore, we need not be worried, but we need to be very, very alert and move forward, implementing the changes in a robust manner, in a vigorous manner. And finally, the question that what is going to happen to management education? And it will not be justified if I do not address this question, personally being from management field. And one of the immediate changes is required. And if you have seen the recent guidelines of Association of Indian Universities on implementation of NEP, very, very comprehensive document, it says that they have to immediately turn into multidisciplinary institutions. They have to increase the number of programs they offer and number of courses from different disciplines to be offered to students. In true sense, interdisciplinary approach has to be brought in. The projects which they have to offer for learning, particularly at the higher order learning outcomes, have to be industry-based transdisciplinary project where students from different disciplines coming together and working to solve same problem, which is real life. Even though this will require regulatory facilitation, as was mentioned earlier at the state and central government level, but believe me, ultimately it has to happen within the institutions. It has to be made to happen by the faculty members in the classroom of that 1 hour, and they have to create that magic. Nothing can substitute this. No regulatory changes will stop you or facilitate you. I think it has to start from within. This is my strongest recommendation. We need to benchmark curriculum globally and be locally relevant, where we can solve the problems which are local, regional, and national has also been emphasized. And therefore, when we work, when we collaborate, particularly when we work towards expanding the learning opportunities for students, we need to break barriers and reach out to, through collaborations, to different disciplines, different cultures, different industries, and different nations. No boundaries should come in between us. Then only we can, in true sense, present learning opportunities for our students. We need to innovate and adopt project-centric blended learning. As you're aware, University Grants Commission has already permitted 40% delivery of regular degree contents through online modes. And this is after the students choose credits from SWAM. Now, I do not know, we've been reduced to only about 40 to 50% delivery, which is expected from us face to face. Now, that itself is a great challenge. How do we address this? And I think one of the solution for this to make our students relevant is to constantly map the skill set and what we offer. Believe me, we did this exercise late last year, and depending on the course, we mapped with about 40 different sectors and industry skill set. We mapped our curriculum with, the gaps found were anywhere between 5 to 40%. Average was 25% across university, where you offer 130 programs across 10 campuses. So that is the gap I think we need to fill. And for this, I feel we need to learn to cohabit with the industry, co-create curriculum and co-own it. Otherwise, only industry will create and co-own it and will keep on standing as onlookers and bystanders. There cannot be any delay whatsoever. Undertake interdisciplinary research, as I mentioned, and deliver solutions to local problems. And not only big academic concepts, I think if we need to move in the direction which government has asked us, we need to bring in innovation, we need to find solutions, we need to promote entrepreneurship and create jobs. That is the real purpose of education. And philosophically talking, while I'll say that while we need to make our students professionally competent, but I think we also need to inculcate in them social sensibilities and social sensitivities, make them good human beings of the society. And to end, I would say I'm reminded of what one of the most renowned researcher in our country, Dr. R.A. Mashelkar, once said. He said, research, which is being emphasized and being talked about too much for last almost a decade, and we have not delivered much, believe me. He says research converts data and information into knowledge and consumes resources. So the research can only consume resources, but he says to convert that knowledge back into money or resources, we need innovation. And imagine if we can complete that cycle, we will never be short of the resources for carrying out cutting edge research. And finally, I'll share just one example that how one single pedagogical intervention can achieve most of the objectives. We introduced a concept which we have copyrighted in the last 1 year. It is called transdisciplinary project-centric learning. Project-centric learning is slightly different from project-based learning. In project-based learning, we remain within the confines of a course or a subject. Whereas in project-centric learning, a project becomes central to all the courses being taught in that semester, in that term, or in that year, including what you had taught in the previous semesters or what you come up with from your qualifying examinations. And this serves the following objectives, where students from different disciplines work together in a group of 5 to 8. Number one, it helps us achieve higher order learning outcomes, particularly beyond application in the context of Bloom's taxonomy. Two, it helps you solve real life problems and get patentable ideas. Three, it serves the purpose of increasing local appeal of the institutions, because most of the problems you'll solve is local. And four, it is aligned with national priorities and strategic development goals of United Nations. And the direct outcomes will be a lot of patents. Many of them will be commercializable and therefore will turn into enterprises. And the worst and the minimum outcome will be a good quality publication, apart from inculcating many, many habits in the students, which have been trying for. For example, we gave them access to 16,000 modules online, and believe me, 7,500 licenses were activated. And in 3 months, they viewed 16 lakh videos. Can we put our students into self-learning mode, which will serve most of the purposes which I think new National Education Policy 2020 envisages? So thank you so much. I'll take any questions, and I think we have an interaction towards the end. Thank you once again for having me. God bless, and look forward to more interaction as I listen to other distinguished speakers whom I know, most of them. Everybody is an expert in their own field. Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for such a nice deliberations and enlightening us. Now, I would like to invite Professor Anil Kumar Saini, Dean, University School of Management Studies, Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University, and a ACSE member, AIIMT, for delivering the first keynote address. A brief profile of Professor Anil Kumar Saini. Professor Anil Kumar Saini is currently Professor and Dean of the University School of Management Studies, Director, Industry Interaction Cell, and Director, Development of GGSIP University, New Delhi. He was appointed as a professor in 2007. He is the member secretary of Indraprastha Internal Quality Assurance Cell of the university. Professor Saini is a postgraduate in physics, computers, and management. He obtained his doctorate degree from FMS Delhi University in the area of information system. Before joining USMS, he was holding a senior academic position at FMS University of Delhi. He carries with him blend of industrial and academic experience of more than 35 years, out of which 6 years in the industry in responsible capacities. So I once again welcome Professor Anil Kumar Saini for the first keynote address.
Thank you so much, I think, and thanks for bearing with me, because as Professor Rizvi said, sometimes technology, we should not become dependent on the technology also. It is something which really definitely helps you, each and everybody, to really perform better. But sometimes it also becomes a bottleneck because it is not in your control. So you have to be aware of that. So first of all, at the very outset, let me convey my gratitude to the organizers of this webinar, which actually has been organized on the theme called National Education Policy 2020. In fact, I had the privilege of listening to the luminaries out here who are my co-panelists also, Professor Raj Singh, and I think the other co-panelists, Dr. Pankaj Gupta and Dr. Irfan Rizvi. I think they have been able to really bring out what actually is the intention of the national education policy. Because the kind of theme which actually has been specified to me is talking about the initiatives of the Indraprastha University regarding the management education. But before I move to that, let me just briefly touch upon some of the final aspects of this NEP 2020, which has been the most talked about thing in the since July when it was approved by the ministry as such. As we all know that NEP 2020 actually has been the first education policy of 21st century. And after 34 years, it has basically been able to bring out some change, which we all are talking about change. In fact, Professor Raj Singh also mentioned change. Professor Rizvi also talked about change. In fact, this is a good thing that change is the only constant in this world. And we all know whether we wish or we do not wish, it is going to happen. So it is high time that we should try to accept, yes, the NEP 2020, which actually is talking about the change in multiple ways, the way we are trying to conduct our higher education and the school education. And this NEP policy 2020 actually is primarily based on the four fundamental pillars which you talk of, which has already been mentioned by some of them. The access, where basically we are trying to talk about that the education should be available to all, even the remotest part, anybody basically, irrespective of the culture, distances, geographical locations, the economic status and all that. So that's one focus, the fundamental pillar of this NEP, which is trying to address equity, quality, and affordability as finally accountability, which we have seen that this policy also provides some kind of a regulatory system as well as providing freedom to the institutions to frame the course curriculum and all that. These are some of the major pillars. If you see basically in short, the prominent aspects on which actually NEP 2020 is focusing upon is basically the transformation of the intent and content of the total education domain itself. It is also trying to, from the school perspective, if we see, it is basically trying to shift the burden of school bag to the boon of learning. So if you see the third aspect, which you can think of, which can derive from this NEP 2020, which is basically integrating the local with the global. So we are trying to focus upon the local thing and then finally moving on to the value chain, which is basically going to integrate ourselves with the global perspective also, that is internationalization. It is also trying to aim at making our youth future ready. That means while we are trying to pursue our national goals, but we should also try to look at what actually are the global perspectives so that they are able to look at some of the speakers have said Industry 4.0 and 5.0 and 6.0. So we need to really be working in that direction through the NEP initiative goals. As Professor Raj Singh also said, basically making sure that the students become global citizens. And they also at the same time remain connected to the roots. That is also one of the major things. And very important area to look at, which we derive from this NEP 20, is the what to think. Basically, it's trying to shift the focus from what to think to how to think. So that basically is something which actually we all at the higher education institutions are going to really say, we implementing and modifying and transforming ourselves to enable the students to achieve this on how to think. And the increased autonomy, of course, is there. And as we all know that this policy is trying to align with the 2030 agenda of the Sustainable Development Goals, which actually we have already seen in the recent times. If you look at from the perspective of what we call as Professor Raj Singh as and other speakers also said, that this policy is primarily a policy. It is trying to give you some directions. That means certain targets have been set forth in this policy. However, I mean, within quotes, I'm saying a policy is only a policy. It's only a policy unless actually it is implemented. It is implemented with the seriousness which actually is required on the part of the stakeholders. And we being the stakeholders, as administrators, teachers, students, I think the policy, everybody has to contribute, chip in. We see the role of the institutions, we see the role of the teachers, the students, the faculty members, the management, the government, the state government, central government. I think all have to come together to make sure that it is implemented with the intention it has been aimed at. Even if you all agree with me that the budgetary allocations are meaningless unless we have a proper planning and execution of the key aspects of this policy which have been laid out in the census. So there's an importance of clear roles and responsibilities which actually are required to be taken by the higher education institutions, state government, central government, which actually are the key to the success of these transformational goals. And we can think of India becoming a vibrant knowledge society and global knowledge superpower by making both the school and college education more holistic, which has already been emphasized by many speakers, flexible, multidisciplinary, and suited to the 21st century needs itself. So that is very, very important to look at. What university actually has taken, I would like to just mention few of them, which actually are, or maybe from the perspective of the management as such. I think the big change which we are going to see, whether it is the BBA program or it is the MBA program, I think at both PG and UG level, we find the major impact is going to be what we call as the change in the school system itself. The NEP is talking of the 5+3+3+4. Basically, we're talking about the kind of change. That means after the school education, the graduation actually has been made in two forms called the graduation with 3 years and graduation 4 years. That means with an ordinary graduation and graduation with research, with research degree. So that basically is one change, which of course many of these model guidelines actually are supposed to come up, because we are also at the university, we are also grappling with what actually to be put in the fourth year. If we talk of modifying our BBA programs, the BCom programs to the 4 year scheme. So that deliberation is still going on because of the absence of the guidelines and some kind of a knowledge, more knowledge about this. We are just working on it. In fact, let me share with you that university has already formed an NEP task force, which basically is working on all these aspects. And as we all know that the span of this entire NEP 2020 is basically 20 years. That means we expect it to be completed by next 20 years, which is 2040. And a lot of things actually have to still shape up. Like we mentioned about academic credit bank, we talk of the National Research Foundation, all these things still have to come up. And we still have to see how basically it shapes up. Because today we are talking of the choice-based credit systems and allowing the students the flexibility. In fact, that's another feature of this policy, which we have implemented which are going to be implemented from 21-22 onwards. We are going to provide a lot of electives as well as giving the students an option to choose the courses which they want to pursue. Because that is that's a very, very fundamental change which we see in the past. Earlier, we were talking of a system in our universities and colleges. It's called a mass production system. That means, say, one course to be taught to all the students uniformly across. But as some of the speakers also said, I think we need to look at what actually student is aimed at, what are his passions. So that is what actually this scheme is going to give us, that academic flexibility, where the student has the freedom to choose. That means it is like he has different flowers, he can make his own bouquet. And that bouquet actually will be based on his interest and the passion which he pursues with him. That means a student who actually is interested in learning something about music also while pursuing management, he can do that. So that flexibility is there, which is actually one of the major important features. And in fact, in our university scheme, we are going to incorporate, give that flexibility. We have already drafted the first round of this scheme, which will be shared, of course, with the colleges once we are through with that first round of discussions itself, in which we are giving two options to the student to choose their electives as well as going for the courses of the choice. Again, for that, if you offer more courses, we need to have a look at the faculty requirements also. So that faculty requirements also, which actually comes up along with when you open so many opportunities, that also is being addressed in this policy through what's called the online system. In fact, the scheme also provides kind of blended learning. That means in those subjects or those courses which we have shortage of the faculty members, we can always pursue those courses in the online mode also. So that flexibility also basically is taking care of that advantage which we want to give to the students in choosing or making their own bouquet, so that the college cannot say that I do not give faculty to these courses. So this is what actually is important, and we are addressing this in the university. Specifically, I'll come to that in the end when I mention about it. Another question which basically comes up is that, of course, we are at the moment focusing on 2 years master's program, that is MBA, because although the NEP provides that master's program can be 1 year or 2 years, both. But at the moment we are confining, because we still have to see that for those students who are pursuing graduation with 4 years option, that means with research, they can be offered 1 year program, which is basically the master's program. And not only that, in fact, the students who are pursuing this 4 year program, that means with research, they can directly join the PhD program, the doctoral program also. So that is basically still in the discussion stage. We have not yet come up with that, but definitely that 2 year system we are going to continue with for the current year, that means 2021 onwards. Maybe in the subsequent years we'll try to incorporate once we have the first batch passing out with that four. So before that it will be done. Of course, university and our management is very keen to take up and adopt these NEP guidelines to the extent possible as of now, because as I said, lot of things have to, they're dependent on the state government and the central government also. So we need to really wait for those things to be in place so that we can really adopt those also. Apart from that, what actually is important is that pedagogical changes. I think some of the speakers also touched upon that they talked about the Industry 4.0. Because Industry 4.0, as we have seen, that this basically is talking of the integration of technology in a big way to improve to the productivity and the efficiency gains also. So the same thing actually has to happen in Education 4.0, we don't need to talk about, where we're talking of integrating the technological skills as well. And this is what actually we need to focus upon, and we are trying to again include and give this option to the students whether they would like to go for some skill oriented courses or to say integrating technology in the curriculum itself. These are some of the initiatives which we have already taken in the first round of the draft scheme which we have prepared for the undergraduate and the postgraduate courses in the university. Another thing which actually was mentioned, which is actually we are working upon based on the NEP say provisions, is regarding the characters, you can say making the institution multidisciplinary. In fact, like AIMT is currently operating only in the management domain. If you look at, because the NEP requirement, they say it has to be multidisciplinary. So I think they need to really again rethink and look at how do they make themselves multidisciplinary. So this is one of the agenda before us also, that every institution which is basically running only single stream courses, like even IIMs also have that challenge, that they are currently focusing on management only, so they cannot do that. So they have to go for what's called the multidisciplinary options also, where they open up some other similar courses. Again, that's up to the AIMT management, how do they take it up? But that's going to change the entire character of the institution, which actually is currently being with them. Even accreditation also, which actually is important for improving the quality. If we see that the accreditation, because accreditation ensures quality through the paper process, but over and above what Professor Rizvi also said, the stakeholders have to actually agree upon. When you say quality, or we say talk of research, the research by the faculty members or faculty members who are more suited for teaching, they may not be suitable for research. I think this has to coexist together now. And as I said, the university or the institutions have to choose, either they become teaching institutions or maybe research oriented institutions. That means the core strength basically lies in that. But yes, one thing is clear, whatever you pursue with full competencies. That means try to be more competent in that, improve your strengths in that area, whether it is teaching or research. That is basically is the message which has been conveyed, and this will be taken up as and when actually we look at. As of now, if you see, because the focus actually has been on our education system and focusing on producing the crammers who learn something and reproduce it. But this is what actually NEP calls that institution need to apply, that they need to produce applied thinkers. That means the innovators, because we talk of institutions who can actually, because education institutions are the knowledge creation centers. So we need to really look at how these knowledge which they have acquired, is they are able to apply. And that's what we look at, the startups and all these things that with innovation, incubation, actually have to go along with that. So these are some of the things which actually we find that we are already working on it. But specifically, if you want, I think what I said, we have already initiated some of these things, which includes what I said. Giving options for the students in terms of the selecting the or maybe making their own bouquet of courses which they want to pursue. We are working on it, and this first round of scheme will be made available to them. The university has also is going to set up now what's called a School of Liberal Arts. Basically, liberal arts, that means again opening up many opportunities for the students, whether a student of BBA or MBA, and through this they would be offering courses which can be pursued online by either the university students or the students of the affiliate institution, or even beyond that also. So that basically is something which actually is already under process. University has also created a Section 8 company, which is basically going to assist the students, irrespective of whether what college they are in, to really say work on their ideas which they have, and work towards that kind of a tie-up between of the ideas with the industry partners, the kind of investors, so that they are able to really see, come up with some kind of a startups and later on convert them into unicorns and all that. So these are the things which actually at present are being focused upon by the university. And as I said, this is still in the first stage of discussion which we have. And hopefully we will be able to come out with more clarity once we complete the first round, and then we move to the second round. And we are trying to involve all the institutions also through the coordinators that all these inputs which we actually require for improving and further improving to align that. But as I said, this process of NEP implementation is going to take time because it's a long drawn process, and we have to move in phases. Then only we can achieve that. And what I said, even we are making a provision in the scheme for skill enhancement courses, because skills actually is important. Even I was just trying to look at even US, what they have done recently, their department has announced that while giving jobs to anybody, they can ignore the degrees, even if a person doesn't have any degrees as such, but they have the skill, they should be given preference over others. So skill actually has become very prominent. And in the university, we have already approved that not only the university, but institutions can also adopt the courses which are being offered by UGC as well under the NSQF scheme, with this National Skill Qualification Framework, where we're trying to focus upon the skill-based courses, which actually are partly assessed by the skill sector, skill councils, and partly by the university itself. So we have already launched two courses in this direction in the School of Management, which actually is called Postgraduate Diploma in Data Analytics, as well as Postgraduate Diploma in Entrepreneurship and Startup. So this is all, which is another initiative which we have taken from the current year itself. And apart from that, something on what has been laid out is called the happiness courses, and something which actually students actually want to learn beyond the curriculum, like say yoga, NSS and all that. That also is being given option. And we're trying to reduce that kind of school bag actually has to be made lighter. So we're trying to do that. Apart from focusing on what's called the learning, the project-based learning, which actually is another area, we are trying to incorporate projects at each level. That means in the first year also, second year also, where they try to say apply that knowledge which they have gained to some practical problem. So they are able to relate whatever they have learned in the theory, they are able to apply in some domain itself. So we are trying to make provision in the new scheme also, where we took as project-based learning, which is going to further add the holistic development of the students as such. So these are some of the things which actually university level we are trying to pursue and try to make sure. But as I said, it is too early, because we're in the pandemic, not much discussions actually are happening. We cannot do many things, because as we know, I think Professor Rizvi mentioned about it, online learning, definitely there's no choice with us. I think it is better than having nothing. So still there are studies which have proved, yes, the learning through the online method is not as effective, but actually we find in a physical classroom, where we are able to see, even as a teacher, I can see from the face of the students how much is understood. So that basically is missing in this world. What students are doing is just logging in, switching on the switching off the cameras, and just trying to say just pass the time after that it's over. So that means even teachers also face a lot of issues in this, especially when you talk of subjects like, let's say, your quantitative techniques or say business research, accounting, all these things actually cannot be taught the way we are talking of the online system today. But I think we need to have blended mode where even I think recently, just about a week back, I think the University Grants Commission has also say invited suggestions for one of the report that how can we have even in this online courses also which we are teaching, can we have some part which actually can be assessed by the university also. So they're trying to again bring that blended mode assessment also for discussion, whether it can be done online, offline, how can we integrate it. Even 60% of that can also be done through the online. Even what we say this policy says that 40% coverage of the course can be done through the online mode. Definitely, that means there's a scope. That means what basically is implies to the institution is, especially affiliated institution, that they will not employ faculty for those domains. So they'll be dependent on the programs which actually are being run through the SWAM platform or other platforms. So this is what actually is happening. Still, we are in the very nascent stage to really look at the NEP provisions as such. I think we look forward that in the next 2-3 years, we'll have more clarity, because the things like your National Research Foundation, the technological agency, which is supposed to develop such modules to enable all this learning, teaching learning, to basically create a level playing field for all the institutions, whether it is private or public sector itself. The academic credit bank, all these things actually will shape up only once we have more clarity and more setups actually are made operational. Then only we can think of incorporating those things. Even today, because last week we were discussing about how do we provide this provision of academic credits. Because if you look at, let's say, if I allow a student to pursue this course, how do I ensure that the credit actually is maintained? Because it is only with the university, then how do we transfer to other universities? So unless a system is created that where we can have that kind of academic credit, which is stored somewhere, student can gather those credits and he can pursue at his own pace. Not only when 1 year itself he has to complete, he can take 5 years to complete his degree. Maybe he's working somewhere and come back and again join that program and maybe do that. So that flexibility actually, it can only be provided once we have all the systems in place by the government and the central state government and the central governments. So this is all from my side. Thank you so much, and sorry for being late in joining, and because of the technological hiccups, which are beyond our control. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Professor Saini, for making us aware about the initiatives taken by the GGSIP University and what new modes are going to be there in new education policy. So now I would like to invite Professor Pankaj Gupta, Dean, University, Dean OP Jindal Global University, for delivering the keynote address. A brief about Professor Gupta. Professor Pankaj Gupta is a Fulbright Fellow, CMA, GCPCL Harvard, Fellow of ICAI, and an alumnus of Lucknow University and IIM Ahmedabad. He has about 30 years of professional experience to his credit and a very successful track record as an academic and an exceptional institution builder with several top organizations such as IIMT Ghaziabad, Symbiosis Bangalore, Educom, IIM Kozhikode, IIHMR University, University of Washington, USA, SP Jain Dubai and Singapore, IIM Raipur, Rohtak, Jaipuria Group, ICSEI, and among others, many more. Under the leadership of Professor Gupta, both Symbiosis Bangalore and JRE School of Management became one of the leading B schools in India in a short span of time. IIM Ahmedabad has written a case study on Jaipuria Group on its transformation journey. There has been a great growth of all the institution under the leadership of Dr. Gupta. So now I once again invite Professor Pankaj Gupta to deliver keynote address. Sir.
Very good afternoon. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Oh, very nice. So first of all, thank you very much, Arshia ji, and all the respected member in AIMT, for inviting me here, and it was really great to listen to the previous speakers, including the address by Brigadier Saab Verma ji and also Professor Raj Singh, for whom I have very high regards. So the topic given to me is about making students, you know, industry ready. I'm known for, you know, making very open and sometimes, you know, the bold statements, which I will not disappoint you even now. Question is that why to make a student industry ready? That also is very important. Question is that if there is somebody who want to go in a certain field, are we really deciding that that person really want to go there? Or whether that person has a required passion, ability and faith? I created this model known as Aruchi, Yogyata and Vishwas model. That is a passion, ability and faith model, by which you need to know what is the swabhav of a person, then what is the swadharma, and then accordingly you nurture that person according to that. And then somehow what is happening in most of the business school, I have been to IMT Ghaziabad for a long time, then I was director with many institutions. And along this whole line, I have also gone through certain process of self-awareness, spending a lot of time in silence in the Himalayas. And like Professor Raj Singh, I was earlier professor of finance and accounting. Most of my research is all in that area. But later now I have converted into self-awareness, meditation, mindfulness, and yoga nidra, which I feel is more like a vidya. You know, what vidya says, you know, sa vidya ta vimukta. And as against that vidya, and also why it is known as vidya, because it is something which is not going to change. And avidya, you know, you may talk about the machine learning, AI, big data, blockchain. So they are hot today. Tomorrow something else will become hot. So question is that, are you in a position to firstly develop a human being well, and to align him or her according to what is the real swabhav and swadharma, and then develop those muscles and capacity in that person so that the basic level of adaptability is there. I'm not saying that you do not give them inputs about what is latest happening in the world or what the industry need, but more important than that is, you know, to provide a person a level of self-awareness. And I believe even in the new education policy, there's a lot of focus on that. And so I'd like to say that the new education policy is only one trigger at this moment, but the more important fact is that in the business schools, it is generally the case that, you know, where the, you know, how the student decide about, I have to take finance or marketing or HR or business analytics, they see what is the placement of my current senior batch. And accordingly they decide, okay, I also want to do this, without realizing the fact that whether you are meant for that or you may be more successful in something else. So there is a, and most of the time they are driven either by abhav and prabhav, but not in swabhav. Abhav means something is, you know, missing in me, therefore if I do this MBA or I do this thing, then I'll be good enough. Prabhav means, you know, somebody else, you know, is doing something, so I also need to do that. I'm reminded of a story, because I know people have been hearing for almost 1 hour, so let me also enliven it by, you know, telling one story. And I say, as such, you know, since we have been doing so much work on online education, it is another very important thing for us to know that how to make our classes more engaging. Because gone are the time when you'll say, oh, you should better be here, you should better, you know, keep your mobile phone off. It is not possible. We have to make technology and all these things, you know, friendly to our advantage, and not to fight with them, but to, you know, collaborate and co-create with them. So that story is, you know, we all have heard about that story, that a guy who was telling this, you know, the topis, the caps. He was going in a village, and in between he thought to take a small nap, and all these, you know, the, in an open box, his all these caps were there. So there were monkeys on that tree, so that all the, and actually he was wearing that cap, so monkeys have also taken that cap. And when he woke up, then he saw that there is no cap, the entire thing is empty, and then he saw that all the monkeys were wearing the caps. So then he said, okay, no problem. So he just, you know, threw away his cap, and the monkeys also threw away the caps. कहते ना मंकी थोड़े नकलची से होते हैं तो उसने सब टोपी उठाया एंड देन ही वेंट ऑन हिज वर्क वाज डन एंड द स्टोरी गोज ऑन यू नो हिज सन ग्रोज अप एंड एज सच यू नो दैट देर आर पेरेंट्स विल से माय सन शुड फॉलो माय फुटस्टेप्स दिस इज द वे बट सम अदर पेरेंट मे नॉट थिंक दैट वे दे विल से ओके आई हैव रीच्ड टू दिस लेवल लेट माय सन गो व्हाटएवर वे ही और he want to explore or what way my daughter want to explore. But anyway, in this story that boy also decided to follow his father's footsteps. So he also started selling his caps. So again, he went in place of his father to sell the caps to the city. On the way, somehow he also landed in the same tree and he also thought to take a nap. And as you know, he was also wearing the cap. So monkeys came. And when he woke up, then all the caps were gone. So he remembered, oh yes, my father told me how to handle and how to fix this problem. So then he just, you know, take out his cap and threw it on the ground. And then, you know, he was expecting the other monkeys will also throw their caps, but it didn't happen. By that time, the monkeys were not there, their children were there. So all those children were wearing the caps and one monkey's children, child came and he took away that cap also and he started wearing that on his head. So the point which I want to highlight here is that somebody who told 15 year back, 10 year old that it is the way to do, it is a success formula, all those success formula are totally redundant at this moment. And therefore, there is a book, you know, what you say, what got you here won't take you there. So what is here and what is there, that also has to be identified. Many people are running for the sake of money, money, money is the honey of a man. But are we talking about a balanced portfolio? Are you talking about taking your health as a priority? You know, if maybe these days I saw some of my people I lost due to Corona, I got suddenly present to the health thing that how much great thing we have if we are healthy, our near and dears are healthy, the society around is healthy. So health, then the family goals, spiritual goals, society goals, many things. Like we talked about the balance scorecard for an organization. You know, like we talk about learning and growth, then internal process, then we talk about customer delight, and then we talk about financial goal. So in the same manner, we need to nurture our, you know, young boys and girls to look into their life right now, rather than going and just trying to be industry ready. And we remember that famous interview in this Three Idiot, when Raju Rastogi goes for the interview and he tells everything very openly. कि मैं तो ये किया, वो डायरेक्टर के यहाँ ये किया, वहाँ से कूदा, all these things. And they said, "Sahab, you are very, very bold, very frank. We do not need this." And he says, कि देखिए साहब, after a lot of thing, you know, I have got this habit, I have got this attitude. Now, आप अपनी नौकरी संभालिए, मैं अपना ये attitude संभालूंगा. So, for that, a little level of self-awareness is very much needed, where a person knows what is the seed of possibility I carry within me, and how I have to go there. Rather than trying to put, what you can say, putting some makeup that will, you know, do some work. But in order to be naturally beautiful, there is, you know, some sifarish can give you somewhere. You can, you know, that you can say, I'm using my crutches. But what beautiful it is if you have a healthy legs. So these are my points. So we need to develop the level of self-awareness among the students and to make them sensitized. And let me share with you that I have interacted with few students from Army Institute. They are working in other organizations. I have heard very good review about them. Everybody says they are very disciplined. They are very, very consistent. They're not like somebody who will join immediately and after 2 months, 3 months, they will say, yahan 15,000 extra mil raha hai, yahan bhag jao, wo chale jao. So what I would like to appreciate Army, I have a great regard for Army. I have a lot of my friends who are there. So that discipline part is already there. That is in a great extent, I must say that. And also the teaching learning always anyway happening. But one input which can be added in the syllabus is some courses on the self-awareness, meditation, mindfulness, yoga nidra. So I think they can make a very big impact. And then we can talk about creating some sort of an IDP. Like you create a sort of a cohort, like some student want to go and work in new defense organizations and the new companies which are coming in India. So time to prepare is now. Suppose Rafale comes to India, they want to have people. So naturally, they'll be very much interested to recruit from an Army Institute because the student have that orientation, they have seen that thing and they also have some right connections. So how to prepare a student for the future jobs? So that is part of the Avidya. But in order to make them dreaming big, you know, the self-awareness is needed so that they are not victim of abhav and prabhav, which again, let me tell you, it is not there in Army Institute. The students are very smart. I have also been part of selection committee in Army Institute earlier when other directors, they invited me. I was living in Greater Noida, so I have a lot of connection here. So many great possibilities are already there in Army Institute. But if we start nurturing every student in this way, if this person has come, what this person want to be in 2 years, then what kind of work they have to do, what kind of summer internship, what kind of winter internship, what kind of cohort. Suppose somebody want to go in defense cohort, defense industry, and why in India? Why not our student can go and join in US or France or Germany? So creating that mindset and then with that cohort, doing the relevant kind of research, creating those kind of industry pieces, building a network on the LinkedIn, self-branding, all these things are needed. So I believe these are very important. And as regard the syllabus is concerned, I have already shared about the courses on Vidya, which are needed. Like I run a center here in OP Jindal, and when I was president of IHMR University and other places, I have always created a center for ethics, spirituality and wellness. So where we do a lot of courses related to like ancient wisdom, you know, what Buddha, Kabir, Khalil Gibran, Rumi, Tao Te Ching, Bhagavad Gita, Bible, Quran, and what is the relevance now, so that it also make people very well-grounded person. And you know, they are developing their own inner sense of well-being, self-awareness and mindful leadership, money to meaning, success to significance. So in this way, they are able to know who they are and what they have to do in life. So Army is already playing a very important role. Whenever there is problem, when civil thing fails, executive fails, then Army is always there to for our rescue, and we are very, very grateful to Army and the Army related institution. So we can create such students from us, and as such you see that, but unfortunately I have noted that if you look at, you know, the Fortune 30 under 30, 40 under 40, 20 under 20, I do not find the students from Army Institute. Or maybe people getting Magsaysay Award or getting, you know, Padma Shri or other kind of honors. So that means those kind of thing also we have to think somehow, that how our students can make a better impact in India and abroad. And the whole thing is start with the person's will. And firstly, all the success created in the mind, then in the heart, and then creating a nice ecosystem around it. So I think this can be done. And I think this, in order to make it successful, and Dr. Rasing was sharing one very important thing. He said that implementation is a very important thing, and I fully agree with him. And for the implementation, since I have worked in corporate as well, been a monk also, so I have seen the 360 degree view of thing. And in order to get the things done, if you say that only faculty will do, it is little too much to ask. Because faculty has to do teaching, they have to do research. And also there is a competing, I want to do ABDC, A category, I want to do an FT50. So that also, the measurement system also has to change. Like if there is a faculty who is finding so blissful to teach, let them teach. Somebody who want to having great satisfaction in research, let them do research. So those kind of flexibility is needed. Like, you know, if you ask, you know, a bird to, you know, swim or a fish to, you know, fly, that is not possible. So we all have to understand our swabhav, and accordingly, I do a program which I was doing with the ministry that was, you know, the teacher to guru program. That how our teachers can transform themselves into guru. And for that, again, the level of self-awareness is very important. And with that self-awareness, you know, I'm in the right direction, and that too in a restful mind. Because our students are these days in the guise of this, you know, being industry ready, they are suffering with FOMO, fear of missing out. Ye na chhoot jaye, ye na ho jaye. So they have to be put at ease. Ki boss, wherever you are happy, blissful. Now what you have to do? मेरे एक मेंटर हैं कौन शेखर विजयन जी, तो वो कहते हैं कि जो प्राप्त है वो पर्याप्त है. एंड देयर इज अ बिग विजडम इन दिस कि जो मिला हुआ है उससे हम आगे की तैयारी करें, रादर देन ईच एंड एवरी टाइम आई थिंक साहब ये कमी है वो कमी है. एंड इन दिस वे इफ वी फॉलो दिस काइंड ऑफ मॉडल, यू विल सी मोर रिस्पॉन्सिबल पीपल कमिंग फ्रॉम आवर इंस्टीट्यूशन हु विल बी नॉट ओनली सक्सेसफुल इन टर्म्स ऑफ फाइनेंस and those worldly things, but let me tell you that those things are not real, because those things can be taken away any day. You may, somebody may think I'm a great, I'm having this designation, you know, I've been to multi-crore salaries as well, those things, and you know, I'm so and so, but all these things are unreal. They can be taken away any day. So what is real, really yours? If my young student can get that feeling, and also my, you know, the teachers who can convert into guru, they know what is the right goal to achieve, and that too in a restful manner. Restful ka matlab ye nahi ki masti ho gayi apna. No, somebody who is restful, who is meditative, they are much more productive. I still work 18 hours a day, but I do yog nidra, and with the yog nidra, if I do 45 minutes, it is equivalent to 3 hours of sleep, to which I teach my students. So we have a center for meditation mindfulness in OP Jindal, and we teach these courses. So I believe these are very important incorporation in the syllabus, which we should do. And having the tie-ups with the companies. When I was director of Symbiosis, I started those, you know, collaboration on the big data with HP and IBM in 2008 itself. And you know, then they were coming and teaching, they were also noticing who are the students whom we can recruit. So it was creating a very nice win-win kind of relationship. So see, I am a professor, I can keep talking, but Arshia ji, whether my time is over or do I have some more time? Arshia ji?
You can continue.
Okay. So maybe 2-3 more minutes I will take. Sure. Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am.
Please
go ahead. Thank you. So the question is, there was a book by Srikant Datar, who is now the dean of Harvard Business School. So he spoke about that people are generally taking what doing and having. You do this and you will have this. But doing ke upar kya hai? Doing ke upar a being. That who you are being. Like if somebody who is being late, नॉट बींग सेंसिटिव टू टाइम, तो आप देखोगे क्या वो ऑफिस में हर जगह लेट आएगा, उसके असाइनमेंट्स ऑल दीज विल बी लेट, इवन यू सी दैट द कार सर्विसिंग विल गेट डिलेड, इवन इफ शी हैज टू मैरी द डॉटर दैट विल आल्सो गेट डिलेड. सो वॉट इज दैट? इट इज अ जनरल बींग विच इज रिलेटिंग टू द एक्शन दैट इज अ डूइंग, एंड द डूइंग इज गिविंग यू हैविंग. सो एंड समटाइम्स देयर इज अ प्रेशर, यू डू दिस एंड पर्सन इज हैविंग अ डिफरेंट माइंडसेट. That person will feel it is a more of a pressure. So changing of the being is very important, and for the changing of the being, these inner journey things are very important. Even and also sort of regular level of enrichment is needed. Like even now, I spend 2 hours of time in learning every day. Even right now, I'm having, you know, 2 courses which I keep learning. Because the moment you stop learning, then your growth and everything stops. And so I think the being based, and also when you have that kind of possibility, and also workshop like, you know, the who am I? You know, are you this body? Are you this, you know, the surname? Are you this gender? Or who you are? So I think these kind of thing have to be given due importance, and it will make a very, very important contribution. So in this way, people will try to be like what Buddha last parting was, words were, be a lamp to your life. Aap deepo bhava. Do not try to bother about other lamps. You yourself be a lamp. And believe me, love, whatever little, you know, inner journey I have got in my life, I know that whatever you need is already given to you. And the external sense of happiness, I also teach a course on happiness also. So we see that the Western concept of happiness is like, you know, you enjoy this, you have a big BMW, you have a big, you know, house, and so on and so forth. But still, we see that there are a lot of people who have all that, still they commit suicide. They are always in a sense of, you know, being upset every time. So then our Vedanta says that it is like, you know, when we see a moon, nice moonlight coming, it is not the light of the moon, but it is the reflected light of the sun. In the same way, whatever so-called happiness we feel is also not coming from those objects, but it is a reflection of the self. So if you manage self well, each and everything will be set right. So I believe that in order to make a student ready, if the person is self-aware, he or she will anyway do whatever is needed. So ek kehte na, ek ko sadhe sab sadhe sab sadhe sab jaye, jo tu siche mool ko phule phale aghaye. So it says that, you know, you just nurture the root and it will take care of everything. So I will say that a combination of gaan, gyan and dhyan is very important. You know, we have, aapne jo shuruaat kiya Saraswati ji ka tha, to Saraswati ji ke symbol kya hai? There is a veena, there is a gaan. Then you have a pustak, veda, there is a gyan. And then you have a mala, there is a dhyan. So that has to be nurtured in our curriculum. Ki jaise maan lo finance and accounting hi padha rahe hain, maan lijiye, for example, then how somebody can write a poem on something? How somebody can, like, you know, you talk about ki bhai satyam mein ye ho gaya scandal, you know, global crossing mein ye ho gaya. Can you express that by a song or by a small skit in the class? Many such things are needed. Like you teach them how to be an effective communicator. अरे भाई कम्युनिकेशन में ये नहीं होता, इट इज नॉट लाइक यू नो दैट समबडी इज हैविंग अ फियर इन पब्लिक स्पीकिंग. यू नो, वी जस्ट सिंपली टेल देम इन वन बैड एक्सपीरियंस, ओ यू आर नॉट गुड इनफ, वी लेबल हिम और हर लाइक दैट. दैट इज वेयर देयर इज अ प्रॉब्लम. यू सी द सेम स्टूडेंट चैटिंग इन अ कैंटीन, दे आर परफेक्टली कम्युनिकेटिंग विद ईच अदर. सो ऑलरेडी एवरी गुडनेस इज ऑलरेडी देयर विद इन देम. There is no lacking in them. And that is what we as a mentor and we as a guru, we have to bring the goodness from them. And also it is not only responsibility of only one communication teacher to focus on teaching communication ability, but each and every person. So we all work as a acharya, we work as a gurus, and then we see how we have to nurture the talent. So these are some of my thought, and I'll be happy to give answer to any questions and all that. I'm very passionate about this whole topic. And also I'd like to say one thing, that gone are the days when we talk about campus to corporate. Corporate to campus should also be initiated, which when I was co-chairing the education committee in PhD chamber, then we said that the people who are so-called like VP and CXO, they're also very lonely. They also need, you know, some sort of a nurturing thing. Ki bhai aap aao, you please come and give a talk on your great success story. Why don't we write cases? or why don't you join a PhD program? And the corporate head honchos are also very much scared at this moment. They feel like, mera kya hoga agar mujhe nikal diya to. So in that way, Army Institute can call them. Yeah, bhai, we will help you in getting PhD. You start with a guest faculty, then visiting faculty. And in this way, you take it forward. But a self-aware mind will find all these possibilities and all these things will happen on its own. And as regard execution, finally, KRA, KPI, milestone, deliverables, timelines, jaise corporate mein manage hota hai, that is how we have to build that mindset. उसके लिए प्रोफेशनल्स होने चाहिए. यू कैन नॉट गिव दिस वर्क टू अ फैकल्टी कि भाई तुम ये भी कर लो, तुम ये भी कर लो, देन अदर थिंग विल यू नो सफर. सो विद दिस लेट मी स्टॉप हियर एंड थैंक यू सो मच वंस अगेन फॉर दिस अपॉर्चुनिटी. आई एम रियली ग्रेटफुल. नमस्कार.
थैंक यू सर फॉर सच ए नाइस डेलिब्रेशंस एंड ब्रिंगिंग बैक अस टू आवर रूट्स बाय टीचिंग अस अभाव स्वभाव एंड प्रभाव एज वेल एज सेल्फ अवेयरनेस एंड स्पिरिचुअलिटी. थैंक यू वंस अगेन सर. वुड लाइक टू इनवाइट Professor Irfan Rizvi, Professor IMI New Delhi and member ACAC AIMT for delivering the thematic address. A brief profile about Professor Irfan Rizvi. Professor Irfan Rizvi is the Professor of Leadership and Change Management, Chair Program OB and HR Area at International Management Institute, New Delhi. Sir's professional career has been an exciting journey full of learning and growth. It has helped him place great value on open-mindedness, lifelong learning, humility, self-confidence, and assertiveness. He considers that the purpose of life is to experiment and experience, break perceptual silos, and spread joy, which he does with gusto. His major professional interest lies in developing leadership practice, leadership communication, and facilitating change in the society and institution in general and individuals in particular. His mission in life to be a facilitator in the growth of individuals and their collective enterprise through training, teaching, research, counseling, coaching, and mentoring. So, I once again welcome Professor Irfan Rizvi, sir, for delivering the thematic address, sir.
Namaskar, good afternoon, and adab to everyone. Good afternoon, and can you hear me clearly? Am I
yes,
audible?
Sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, fair enough. Okay. So it's a pleasure to be here, and you know, it has been a wonderful since you started off listening to these great speakers, you know, Professor Raj, whom I have heard many times, and beginning with the Brigadier Goyal, and then Commodore Chawla when he laid out the, you know, path ahead, and then Professor Raj, and then my friend Pankaj Gupta. You know, at this point in time, my thinking is जो प्राप्त है वो पर्याप्त है. सो यू ऑलरेडी हैव हर्ड एंड गॉट व्हाट यू वांटेड. प्रॉब्ली माइंड वुड बी एब्सोल्युटली रिडंडेंट, बट नेवर्थलेस सिंस यू हैव इनवाइटेड मी, सो आई विल डू माय जॉब. आई एम नॉट गोइंग टू स्पीक मच अबाउट द, सो आई मीन आई एम एड्रेसिंग माय लर्नेड पैनलिस्ट, फेलो टीचर्स, आई कंसिडर देम टू बी मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट इन दिस एंटायर, एंड स्टूडेंट्स एंड अदर पीपल हु आर सिटिंग. I'm a very small fry in the galaxy of panelists that you have on the over here. Probably I would not be speaking something which would be very seminal, but nevertheless, something which comes to my mind, I'm sharing what is there in my head. Okay. You see, NEP is a document that is holds a lot of value in future. At times it is exciting and it's very scary also, because the kind of ambition that is there, whether we will be able to achieve it. Many provisions in NEP, some new and some old, and some rigid. The recipe is ready, but we need to start cooking. Putting things together does not enough. You know, you need a great chef to be able to, you know. So idea is great, but we have to see its implementation, as Professor Raj very aptly put it out. Okay, so we may have great plans, and as they say that man proposes and God disposes, we have to see its implementation. We have to see the proof of the pudding, because do remember, there is always many slips between the cup and the lips, and this time around we did not we should not slip. Very ambitious, wonderful, very scary at times also. The theme of the topic that has been given to me is to propose way ahead and recommendation for transition of AIMT. Probably this has been given to me because of my passionate involvement. I would say passionate because I feel for AIMT, a great institution, great people, and association as an AC member. I had the privilege of meeting faculty members, Brigadier Commodore Chawla and others. Arshia has been a good friend all along since we got to know each other. And what am I going to say is, you know, still an outsider perspective. I can't cook things for you. You have to cook it for yourself. So I'll begin with what Rumi said. When I was young, I was very smart. I wanted to change the world. But now I'm more mature and wiser. Now I want to change myself. And, you know, just putting things together, but as Professor Raj said, and Pankaj, I will call him Pankaj, as a good friend. Pankaj said, all these meshes together, at the end of the day, it is we who have to do it. No one else will do it. Okay. So I'll be very quick in enumerating what is, in my opinion, AIMT can do. I'm not going to use the word should do because I'm no one to prescribe. But I'm also cognizant of the fact that what I say could be absolutely meaningless, because unless the people at AIMT and other army institutions decide for themselves. Do remember, we don't have to be imitators. We have to be pioneers. In order to become a pioneer, you have to chart out a path which is best suited for you. Again, borrowing a term from Pankaj, he said, Swabhav and Swadharma. What is good for you may not, what is good for others may not necessarily be good for me. And therefore, I need to pick up things which are best suited for me. Okay. So the question comes in, how do I want to transform or translate myself as an AIMT? Okay. Has to be done by me. I need to start the journey. And before I start the journey, I need to think through as to what is needed by me. Okay. As I said, a caveat, it's not prescriptive. These are my thoughts. Okay. Let me put it forward. I have put it on together. So I'll save some time for the questioning, etc. Number one, please do understand that future is built on the foundation of the present. Unless you have a sound, if your foundation is slippery, it's on a shifty sand, you can never ever build a solid future on it. If the present is shaky, then future can never ever be realized. Moral of the story is very simple. Consolidate what you are good at right now. Because on this foundation, you will build up your future. What you are doing good right now, as I understand, your MBA program is doing very well. You know, the placements are good. And we have already got recognition from Pankaj and others as to how they are recognized. I think that's one area where you would like to consolidate. Second, as I understand, the BBA program is still in its nurturing stage. So therefore, we need to start focusing on that before we take on anything else. Let's not bite more than we can chew. There would be great provisions, yet we need to be thinking in terms of how can we consolidate our position. So consolidation before expansion, as in the army said, that command and control, consolidate before you move further, because you never know what may happen tomorrow if you have to retrace. Number two, decide whether what kind of institution would you like to be under the provisions of NEP. Would you like to be a research intensive institution, or you would like to be a teaching intensive institution? Where does your strength lie? Where does you think your future lies? And since the NEP gives us the provision of freedom to choose either of the path, you know, So research incentive in intensive, which means equal emphasis on research as well as teaching, and teaching intensive, which means more focus on teaching, less on research. Okay. Again, as I said, let's not be imitators. Let's be pioneers. What is best suited for me? Swabhav. And you need to check it out with yourself. Where would you like to have focus? And I would add on something to it, that many places, many times, do remember we call ourselves teaching learning institutions. And in order to chase the number game of research, many times good quality teachers are kept aside, because good quality teaching is something which is not very, very tangible, other than students' feedback, and students are gone, your great teaching is also gone. They may keep in touch with you, they may remember you as an institution, but then when you are publishing, there is nothing tangible about it. When you are publishing, you know, A star and this, that, and the other, then there is something which is solid, which is tangible. Many times we as an academic institution tend to chase this tangible stuff at the cost of intangible teaching learning. My very strong recommendation, I can only recommend, is that please start valuing your teachers, great teachers. And as Pankaj has already said, don't try to fix everyone cannot do everything. There are great teachers and there are great researchers. And I have seen many times the great teachers are undervalued vis-a-vis great researchers. Both of them are very, at the end of the day, the students come to your campus not because there are great researchers. They come in because there are great teachers. And as what happens in the classroom really transform them to become what they want to become. So I would suggest incentivize great teachers. Don't insist upon great teachers to produce great research. Let them do only one great thing. Let people choose their path. Okay, prepare ground. And so research is also important. And as Professor Raj very rightly pointed it out, that research which is relevant to the needs of the society, which fulfills the needs of the, so applied research. Of course, there is nothing wrong in bringing up, creating new knowledge and disseminating, but research which is more oriented towards solving the problems of the society, industry, and so on, that is something which also needs to be encouraged if you want to really be respected by the industry and so forth. Okay, so that is something which we need to be very clear in terms of what kind of research we would like to promote, how do we like to promote, what kind of great teaching we would like to promote, how do we promote and incentivize it, and how do we create necessary resources to be able to do that. Things are not going to happen in a void. We have to empower and enable our faculty members to be able to do that. Okay, many times a faculty member becomes a jack of all and master of none. Okay, I suppose that's a recipe for some kind of a problem down the line. Therefore, it is very important that let faculty members choose where they think they would like to contribute the most and see the magic happening down the line. Okay, so creation of resources, enabling and empowering environment or ecosystem is very, very important, which you would like to do, because that's where things will happen. Number four, integrate professional education with vocational education. So right now you have only two programs, so you have ample scope for introducing short-term diplomas in various emerging areas. Okay, now I think the world over, in India also, we have become quite accustomed to the blended learning mode of online. So there are opportunities to do that, though it's a $1 million question. Everyone has got, as Professor Raj said, overnight we shifted from offline to online. How many of us did it willingly? Because there was no choice available, whether to the students or to the faculty. We have yet to do solid research in terms of what kind of value does online teaching add. In the absence of nothing, you know, something is better. So we have been doing it. I suppose it's very, very important to have more seminars. I would suggest Commodore Chawla next time around to have a webinar wherein we try to evaluate what is the best way of teaching through the online mode, if this is what is going to be the future. Okay, how do we, because it opens up many opportunities, but there are trials and tribulations also. because we have seen one of our very important speakers today, Professor Saini, has not been able to join because of the technical glitches. Okay, and these technical glitches are there, though he has all the equipment available, whereas our students are sitting in remote corners of the country with not even access to the net. So you can understand that this entire online teaching can never ever become a panacea in a country like India, where there is resources are unevenly distributed. So it might be a great idea. I'm also a votary for Industry 4.0, but I would like to also consider in terms of what is best for India. For me, technology replaces people. And what we have in India is people. That's our greatest resources. If they are replaced, then what? There's a question which probably researchers and academics will have to think. So you can think in terms of vocational student courses to be offered, short-term, long-term, diplomas, which maybe again, faculty members can sit down together and put their heads together to find out. Number five, build your systems and processes and reputation through accreditation. You already have NAAC, you have already, but see what next, okay? Because it's not merely a paper, it is the processes which are set right when we go through accreditation, okay? You need to identify the relevant ones for you. Don't go blindsided by it. Many times, I mean, I have become kind of a non-votary for those business magazines doing their surveys, etc. At the end of the day, is the peers who are going to give you the, so NAAC and NBAs, they are more important than anything else because they focus on the process and outcomes. I think you would like to look into that, okay, and build up your reputation through that. Number six, as Professor Raj also said, and everyone has been saying, because NEP also talks about, become a more holistic institution. Not an institution which is merely into teaching, learning, but it is much more than that, which is into contribution to the society as a whole. You know, everyone talks about wellness and well-being. Well-being is a concept which has become all the more important today. The post-COVID scenario for last 1 year, we have been closeted in the house. There is a huge question in terms of well-being, okay? Everyone has become much more aware of well-being does not come on. We could be physically safe by living in a house, not exposing ourselves to outside world. But are we mentally stable? There are lots of mental issues coming in, and that does not reflect well-being. Well-being reflects when you are psychologically, financially, mentally, spiritually, socially, you feel absolutely fantastic at all these levels. It's a holistic concept. We need to see to it that not only our students, but also our teachers and faculty members and other staff are in a state of feeling, a state of well-being. And that's what will make them perform better. That's what will make them. There are enough researches. We just finished a research on this as to the relationship between being well-being and employee engagement. And there is a very high correlation. So you will get great students, great learners, great teachers, great officers, if you ensure that they are in a state of well-being and they will be much more engaged and productive on the job. So that is something which is important. So in order to see holistic development, focus on research, teaching, learning, et cetera, has to be there. Okay, introduction of newer courses, plus most important, as others have also pointed out, we would not like to create money earning machines. We would like to create sensitive, empathetic beings, and therefore introduction of courses on humanities, arts, along with STEM, science, technology, engineering, okay, has to be included in that so that we can create holistic individuals, okay? Holistic individuals as teachers and students, okay? And they have to become citizens of the globe, because this COVID thing has made us realize how important right now India is so much dependent upon the help from other countries. If we don't consider it us to be, you know, a citizen of the globe, a citizen of the universe, if we don't believe in going back and believing in Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, things are not going to happen. Otherwise, we'll become more restricted to ourselves. So these are the seven things which I wanted to talk about. if I am finishing it early before time, I think is all the more better because you have had showing your patience for quite some time. Okay. Now, how to go about it? So these are certain things which can be done. How to go about it? I would very strongly urge each of the Army institution, please, for God's sake, sit down together as faculty members, put your heads together to find out under the umbrella of NEP, in the light of what you are good at and what you are not so good at, what are the opportunities available in future? Work out, find out what would you like to do. Identify projects. Create project teams around these projects, whatsoever it could be. Promoting research, relating holistic education, this, that, and the other. Because ultimately, you have to do it for yourself. Create task forces, project teams. It's very important for the head of the institutions to again empower and enable these people who are going to be part of these teams. Then only the change will happen. Change is not going to happen because NEP has come in. Because XYZ says ki ye hona chahiye. Change usi vak badla usi vak hoga jab hum chahte hain. As Mahatma Gandhi said, be the change that you want to see outside, we have to start from. So you will be seeking autonomy. First of all, you have to give autonomy to others to operate within. It cannot be, unless people themselves want to develop the institution, it would not go, it would not grow. Last two pieces, as I said, that this is my favorite pet statement. Don't be an imitator, be a pioneer, be yourself. If you become an imitator, you would always be second or third. You will never be first. Think of becoming the first, which means do what you want to do and do it the best possible manner. As Walt Disney, who created the entire empire or Disney World and whatnot, he said to his employees when he created the first Walt Disney that do whatsoever you're doing, do it so very well that they come back again. And this time around, they come back with their friends. If as each of the Army institutions, each of the institutions in our country, whatsoever we are doing, if we'll do so very well, then there is absolutely no reason why we can't grow and become what we want to become. Okay, so these are the most important things to be done. And sky is the limit. What is needed is simply the will to do things. And I'm sure under the able leadership of Commodore Chawla and the team that AIMT has, and I'm sure the similar kind of leadership and team is available in other Army institutions all over the country, we have great possibility of bringing about a substantive change, some substantive improvement in what we want to come. We have a policy support. Now we have to take the necessary action in this direction. Okay, you have great alumni, great students. I think you have all the ingredients. It's just that we need to mix them together like a chef and come up with a wonderful, wonderful, tasty dish, which can serve not only the country, but entire globe. Thank you very much for your patience. I stop myself here. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for such a nice deliberations. And surely we can assure you that AIMT is going to become pioneer and not an imitator. And we are going to be the, you can say, best chef in the country. So thank you once again. Now, I would like to invite our guest of honor, Honorable Member of Parliament, Rajya Sabha, Dr. Susmit Patra, for addressing the audience. A brief profile about Dr. Susmit Patra. Dr. Susmit Patra is Honorable Member of Parliament, Rajya Sabha. He is the member of Vice Chairman Panel of Rajya Sabha, Member Parliamentary Department Standing Committee on Human Resource Development, which covers the Ministry of HRD, Women and Child Development, Skill Development and Entrepreneurship, and Sports and Youth Affairs. He is also a member of Parliamentary Joint Committee on Office of Profit, youngest Rajya Sabha MP from Odisha. He is the National Spokesperson and Media Coordinator for Biju Janata Dal, Secretary and Member of State Council of Biju Janata Dal, as well as member of BJD's IT Wing Core Committee. As far as Sir's education qualification is concerned, Sir is a PhD in business management, MBA with a specialization in HR, and a law graduate. Apart from his political and social work, he is having 17 years of experience in academics, business research, industry, and corporate sector. He also handled a UNDP Government of Odisha project. He was the Dean of Xavier Emploin Business School, the first Indo-French business school in India, a joint collaboration between Xavier University Bhubaneswar and Emploin Business School France. So I once again welcome Dr. Sasmit Patra for delivering the address.
Thank you so much. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You're audible, sir.
Yes, sir.
Thank you so much. Firstly, warm greetings despite the pandemic, and many thanks to Army Institute of Management and Technology, Commodore Chawla, Brigadier Goel, Chief Guest Dr. Professor Raj Singh, the keynote address speaker, Professor Dr. Anil Kumar Saini, keynote address speaker, Professor Dr. Pankaj Gupta, thematic address speaker, Professor Dr. Irfan Rizviji, distinguished faculty members, and students of Army Institute of Management and Technology. I understand we have very short time. We're supposed to close at 4:45. And firstly, I must thank you for your patience on a Saturday afternoon. To be able to weather 2 hours nonstop is quite a feat. Having said that, it's been wonderful listening to each one of you. I was listening very quietly. And I must say that before I start, and I'll try to be as brief as possible, considering the paucity of time, that when the NEP was being discussed, and because I have the good fortune of being on the Standing Committee of the Parliament on Education, now HRD has been renamed as Education, Women, Children, Sports and Youth. That's quite a long narrative for a committee. But the fact is, when this NEP draft was being discussed, and Professor Kasturi Rangan and his committee had done a commendable job in terms of coming together and creating this wonderful document, which has actionable points. One of the key concerns that we discussed, and I cannot, of course, share a lot of information because, again, in India, we have this confidentiality clauses on every point. Whenever you want to talk about something, they say, no, sir, you can't talk about this in public. It's confidentiality. You cannot talk about that in public. That's confidentiality. I don't know why we have the right to information. Otherwise, that would also be confidentiality. So, but one thing I can, of course, share with the gentlemen and ladies today and the students is, I think cutting across political, and I talk from the political class, though I belong to the academics and I've had a good long association with academics and I still teach on and off at places. But coming from the political class and from the parliamentary side, I can specifically mention that one of the concerns for NEP before us was the resources. While the actionable points, the KPIs, the KRAs have been very well laid out, and despite the fact that we have clear goals in view, which also have specific timelines, there is a concern that whether those timelines and those goals can be met with resources. I will try to confine my discussion primarily to the theme of transformation of autonomous colleges and proposed methodology for affiliated colleges. And in that regard, I will confine my discussions to only section 10.12 of the NEP, which talks about higher education institutions becoming autonomous, self-governing entities and the practice of affiliation being stopped. And which basically means that the affiliated colleges, a terminology that we are all conversant with for many decades, would be actually phased out over the next 15 years to become either autonomous degree granting colleges, or the affiliating clause, the affiliating keyword itself would no longer be present in 15 years, and that's the idea. So considering that this is something that is not going to be there in the next 15 years, how do we really take it forward? Now, before coming to the methodology part, I would like to work on the process. The process says that this new regulatory system actually provides for a graded autonomy, which would be carried out on a challenge mode, which basically is a mission mode, in other words, where every affiliating university would be responsible for mentoring its affiliated college so that the affiliated college can develop its capacities, can achieve minimum benchmarks in academic and curriculum matters, has teaching and assessment, and has strong governance reforms, achieves financial robustness and administration efficiency. What it basically means that the child has to one day be cut off from the umbilical cord of this affiliation and become a young adult himself, and then probably progress ahead in life. Now, it's easier said than done. I'd like to first go back a little bit into history. In 1882, in India, we had a Hunter Commission that was actually established. This Hunter Commission basically wanted to understand higher education and undergraduate education. And the first idea of affiliation initially started in 1857 with the dispatch of 1854, an establishment of universities of Calcutta, Madras, and Bombay, which talked about how higher education in India should move forward. Then it went forward with the charters of 1835 and 1836. There was supposed to be a board. We did that. I'm just jumping quickly to 2018-19 from that history. The All India Survey of Higher Education, ISHE, it gives certain facts which are very startling. We have, by this ISHE survey of 2018-19, about 993 universities, 39,931 colleges, 10,725 standalone institutions which are awarding diplomas, and out of these, about 298 are affiliating universities alone, which have roughly about 40,000 colleges which are affiliated across the country. 13 universities among them have more than 500 affiliated colleges, and interestingly, the Chhatrapati Shahuji Maharaj University of Kanpur has more than 922 colleges affiliated to it. It's a very unenviable position for the Honorable Vice Chancellor there to even remember the names of 192 or 922 colleges that are affiliated to that university. I can understand. So given the state of affairs, it is essential that this affiliation mode of academic development or academic assessment or academic rigor must be revisited. Otherwise, if a vice chancellor is presiding over 922 colleges, you can well admire that probably in the next 10 years, even if they were to assess 90 colleges a year, it would take them 10 years to even reach one college. So considering the enormity of the task in hand, it is easier said than done that we would be able to go ahead with it. I completely agree with the government. And since I'm a part and a party to the passage of the NEP in the standing committee as well as in the parliament, of course, it was not passed as an act, but then it is being discussed at various levels when the ministry, it becomes important that how do we really actualize it? And that is where the methodology comes in. And I would not dwell more. It's already 4:47, another 4-5 minutes and I'll close. I think there are 3 or 4 areas that we need to look at, which I already spoke about. First is when the parent, the affiliating university, is trying to strengthen the affiliated university over the next few years so that the affiliated university has the strength, gains that courage to stand alone in this world. In the methodology, what could be the various factors that we could look at? That is something I'd like to share very briefly. Firstly, it's about academic and curriculum matters. Today, academic and curriculum matters are being governed primarily through the minimum standards, laws and regulations of the UGC, which is handed down to the universities, and the universities handed down to the affiliated colleges, and it flows through. So there is a standardization process, and the NAC assessment, you can also assess them. But once you actually move out the affiliated colleges to stand alone degree granting institutions, the bigger concern would be whether the maintenance of minimum standards of imparting education would be sustained. And for that, would the protocols and the standards of education and the building blocks of academic excellence be sustained? For that, what would be the metrics? What would be the quality assurance standards? And how would we meet them are going to be a critical element in the methodology. The second part would be the curriculum. Unfortunately, when you go through the curriculum, not only in higher education, but also in NCRT, because being part of the standing committee, we used to go through the NCRT revision of curriculum. One thing that we always discussed with NCRT and CBSE at the school level also was most of the curriculum dates back to 80s and 90s. Sometimes a computer science book has been written in the 90s or early 2000 and it still talks about the dot-com bust. So therefore, at the end of the day, how does the curriculum review happen? Who upgrades? What are the moderations? How do you go about the curriculum review? What are the standards set? How much of percentage of curriculum should be upgraded over a period of time? The third point I want to raise very quickly is the teaching and assessment. I was listening to Dr. Rizvi and he said very nicely that if, and of course Dr. Saini also spoke about it, was in terms of faculty. Today, the strength, like any place that you go to today, everybody talks about people more than probably anything else. If you go to a manufacturing concern or services sector, anywhere, it's people. But in the academic sector, and being a teacher myself, I have felt that it's the teacher who's the most deprived in most cases. He wants to go for a research scholarship or he wants to go for a seminar. There's no funds. I understand that. But there are funds always to establish large auditoriums. That's also important. But if we do not have the soft capital, if you do not strengthen the academic institution, it is not on chairs, tables, computers, libraries, books. It is the person who's able to impart that to the student, the person who serves it. As Dr. Rizvi said, we need to cook up. Who's that chef? That chef in the classroom is your teacher. So when we want an affiliated institution to move away from being affiliated to becoming a standalone, and it has to have strong legs, those strong limbs are the faculty. They are not going to be the schools and brick and mortar alone. And of course, the challenge of COVID pandemic today is there with us. We are hopeful, God willing, in the next couple of years, we'll not have that. We'll again have open classrooms. We may have blended learning, a bit of this, a bit of that. All of that will happen. But the question is therefore, teaching and assessment, how do these affiliating institutions create KPIs and KRAs that tomorrow a faculty is able to strengthen himself and the institution therefore gets strengthened? It's a very cyclical process as I've seen in a business school. You get good quality students, they have good academics, the faculty are good, they come out as good placements, it creates good value, you again get better students, and the cycle keeps on continuing. And if one of the cycles go bad, it just goes on the reverse till you end up in the bottom of the barrel. Then governance reforms. Today, if you look at the governance reforms and the governance policies, what is the methodology being used? Today, because you have an affiliated institution, you have a university which is looking after it, there is a governance mechanism. I do not say that many institutions have great governance mechanisms. I'm not saying that. But to me, an AIMT or let's say an IMI or let's say a GGISP or let's say a Jain University is probably the top 0.5% of this country. The rest 99.5% is something which again has two or three layers. There's one layer which profits, which maybe, I mean, with all due respect, may be run by people who believe that X number of students into X number of amount is total so much, my expenses are so much, so my total capital outlay and the return on investment is so much. That's one segment of the population. There's a second segment of the population which wants to improve its academic resources but does not have the support system. Like, I know for sure that there are many institutions that I know where some are taken care of. Let's say there is a school of sustainability. It may not be able to sustain itself by its own resources, but since you have another school of management, it provides the resources which cross-subsidizes research, but the school of sustainability adds value to the school of management and thereby enriches it. This interdisciplinary approach, which helps institutions to cross-breed, cross-fertilize, and cross-talk, that helps in going forward. So governance mechanism, financial robustness. I mean, with all due respect, when we talk about NEP, we are committing 10% of the GDP. Forget 10%. Let's talk about 3% of the GDP. I think if we can even invest 1% of the GDP truly in our education sector, we can do miracles with that. But that 1% should not be construed as smart boards in classrooms. That 1% should not be confined to a modern library. The question is, how do we really cater or rather serve that technology on a plate where a faculty is able to make sense? You may be able to buy 500 Harvard cases and have seen, and I've walked into classrooms and professors have been teaching Harvard cases, but they are more just a comprehension mechanism. It's like you read comprehension. The comprehension, this is a narrative, these are five answers. Are Harvard cases comprehension material? No. But then the classrooms, if they have access to Harvard cases, but they're teaching them like they would teach comprehension, then obviously the idea of having a Harvard case in the classroom is defeated. And that is where we need to have clear goals in terms of financial robustness, but also in terms of its use. And finally, I would like to end with administrative efficiency. We have to have administrative efficiency, but mostly we have to have administrative transparency. And if we are to move affiliated universities into affiliated colleges into standalone colleges, then there's a greater onus of transparency on the administrative machinery than ever before. Earlier, you had a big brother who was watching you as an affiliated university. Now you are an existing entity, which has all the strength. Again, I say, 1% of the institutions, maybe 5% of the institutions of this country have the strength to stand alone and be corporate governance excellent. But there is a large majority that should not feel wavered on its way back that today we have the power and the strength and we are not dependent on anyone. Because of that, we can do X number of programs, X number of courses, X number of students into X number of fees. It's so much of money and therefore we can have large classrooms and bigger things to do. So therefore, with these words, I would like to stop. It's going to be about five, but I would like to just tell one thing, that we are together in this boat. There's a lot of political will, there's a lot of parliamentary will, there's a lot of government will, but how that will translates needs to be seen, but we need to be very clear on the actionable points and take them forward together, not on a top-down approach, not on a bottom-up approach, but on a consultative approach of what is suitable. One size fits all will not work. It'll be counterproductive. Rather, we need to have a piecemeal, customized, and micro-phased approach in this regard. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir, for such an enlightening statement and giving us a food for thought. So now I would request our academic head, Dr. Anubhav Verma, to start the open house discussion and take the questions of audience.
Thank you so much, Rahul, sir. Once again, thank you all to all the panelists, and I hope everyone attending this session here would agree that we had good amount of brainstorming session. We had good food for thought to keep us engaged for a good long span of time. We have got a few questions, so I'll be putting forward these questions along with the name. So the first question is by Dr. M.Y. Khan. This question is for Raj Singh, sir. So the question is, NEP 2020 aspires and emphasizes technology in education and attempts to transform education planning, teaching, and learning assessment. But a large number of students do not have access to such technology and gadgets, like what you have also highlighted in your one of the points. How would these excluded students benefit from the new modes of learning?
Thank you for the question, Khan Saab. Yes, this digital divide has definitely caused some kind of issue that students in far off areas not only do not have connectivity, but there's also a shortage of appropriate gadgets. And I think partly what we have done is we have also done it in asynchronous mode, wherein both from the third party contents as well as our own contents, what you've done, we have prescribed asynchronous mode of online teaching where students can do it in their own free time rather than engaging the faculty in real time. I do understand this will solve the problems in a limited way, but at least whenever they have connectivity, particularly the gadget use can be facilitated. For example, in a family, there are three children and there is only one or two gadgets. So I think that problem can be solved. But in the long run, it's the connectivity which has to be of better quality to reach to these students. But in the long run, I also believe that it's the blended mode of learning which will work. Post-COVID, again, to partly resolve this, what we have done, we have come up with a model which according to me is quite sustainable. We're working on a 100-day face-to-face class mode almost forever. And in these 100 days, the focus will be on essentials like the labs which can't be delivered online until we have a virtual reality kind of access to labs wherever they exist in the world, or simulator kind of things which are high tech, which will take time and a lot of resources, of course. So 100 days, most of the time we'll devote to labs. The theory could be delivered through whatever online platforms we have, or maybe both will have parallel, like we did in between when we opened the university and worked very well. So about 30 to 40% students were on the campus and remaining joined us online because we made it optional and attendance was on mandatory. But I think the remaining one third, what we have done is, and personally I have been waiting for this to happen, as if it had to take COVID-19 to strike that will wake up. I think long pending changes in the teaching learning process, which we were negating, which we were delaying, which we were ignoring, I think we've been able to implement. And this one third, we've been able to effectively shift to field-based and research-based activities through which students learn. And believe me, I can give you just data of the semester, which is just winding up. For example, we said one review paper, research paper should be taken as a component of continuous assessment. Maybe 10%, 15% marks can award to it. In management school alone, a management school is quite big in our case. Out of 23,000 students, we account for about 5,000 undergraduate and postgraduate management students. 648 case studies came out of this, 279 projects, which are of good quality after shortlisting, and 179 publications of the quality of Web of Science and Scopus and UGC CARE journals. Now, I couldn't ask more in terms of how research could be integrated and could become a learning tool for students across, starting from PhD, where we have about 1,100 scholars, and PG and UG. But having said this, I must confess that at least in the interim, last time when we were online classes, problems were much more serious. But in the second round now, we are more equipped thanks to some of the government initiatives and initiatives by NGOs, etc. People have better access and better availability of the gadgets. We must keep on trying and create contents which are customized, which are proprietary, to differentiate, because third party contents can be used only in the interim. I hope I have partly answered, at least, if not fully.
Thank you so much, sir, for your views. Thank you. So moving on to the next question, which we have from Professor Rahul Verma. This sir, question is...
Sorry to interrupt, sir. Actually, Dr. Yeah. Pankaj Gupta, sir, and Dr. Rizvi, sir, has something to say. They have raised their hands, sir.
Right.
So please, you can go ahead with the question. You can go ahead with the question. I have a question, so I wanted to ask a question, so...
Okay.
I just
wanted to add to what, you know, Professor Raj has already answered this question, but what I was sharing that there are a lot of people who are also willing to support. You know, the basic question was that if there is somebody who is not having a laptop or a phone, when you talk about the higher education, mainly the people have those resources. But I know that there is a whole chunk of people who are willing to support, including, you know, there are crowdsourcing platform and many, many such things are there. I know, and also the kind of, you know, willingness on behalf of the faculty and principals and directors, where they should see that who is really needing it. And I'm sure those possibilities can also be explored. So I just wanted to add this. Thank you.
No, just to add on, we have been using the Zoom platform where there is a, I mean, even now when we are using this platform, there is a recording facility. Yes. So those who miss out, they can, you know, offline, they can, you know, they can view the lecture, etc. But I suppose that is something which in we are expecting every student to become an Eklavya, that without being taught by the teacher, still learns the best and becomes the best. Particularly in this context, I have seen some of the most brilliant students have been kind of completely jaded, exhausted, and so forth, because of, you know, it's not only a question of 1 hour or 2 hours of lecture, it's 5-6 hours of lecture. So there are health implications and other implications also. So I'm going to take this entire, the idea of blended learning, to what extent blend, and then online learning, not only with a pinch of salt, maybe some few kgs of salt. because that doesn't solve a problem, particularly in a diverse country like ours. That's what.
Right. So I'll move over to the next question. That is from Professor Rahul Verma. This question is for Dr. Sasmit Patra. The NEP 2020 envisions.
Dr. Patra had to leave, you know, he had a little meeting at 5, so he's left. But he said that you can share the questions with him and he'll surely answer them over a mail. And
I'll put this question in front of the dignitaries. So the question is, ki, with this vision of the government, with this NEP 2020 increasing privatization of higher education in India, which may be dangerous and will make higher education lose its quality of equitable growth, then affiliated colleges are asked to be autonomous. The question of funding should also be addressed. How is it envisaged? Can there be philanthropy without concerns about the commodification of education?
Okay, let me try at least partly, though it was meant for Dr. Patra sir. I think if you read the finer lines of NEP 2020, it talks about predominantly about the feasibility of academic institutions. And one of the objectives of large universities being there is to make them financially viable. Dr. Patra referred to AISHE 2018-19, and if you look at some of the data about colleges, particularly in areas like education, in education, 80% of the institutions are less than 100 students. It can never be viable financially, never, no matter how hard you try. So I think larger campus, sharing of resources, making it financially viable is one of the primary objectives of NEP. And I did mention that, yes, those who cannot sustain financially, those who cannot come up with quality systems and processes and programs will have to either piggyback on some larger institution or maybe be a part of the clusters. I don't know what kind of systems the regulatory authorities will do to facilitate, but there are some of the issues being discussed, in fact, that how can you become part of a larger cluster. But I did mention about the bold statement, number of institutions will drastically reduce and each institution on average will have larger students. So I think that partly answers, and therefore sharing of resources is one of the things. Fee points will be under tremendous pressure. If you look at some of the issues of Academic Bank of Credit, it says that the university you are registered with, you have to complete only 30% of credits. Remaining 70% you can cover from all other eligible institutions, including online and open and distance learning kind of modules. Now, if that be so, I'm not saying immediately, but 5, 6, 7 years down the line, when the market understands Academic Bank of Credit, they'll compare the prices for a particular module and they will go for the one which offers you at minimum price the best value. So I think fee controls will become a misnomer. The market determined fees will be under control. The top line of every institution will be under tremendous pressure. So efficiency through use of technology and larger campuses is the way forward. Apart from, of course, funding for research from NRF kind of initiatives, plus industry research is something we will have to attract by becoming innovative. And then only we can, survive. Otherwise, financial viability will remain a question mark if you operate with very, very small institutions.
Sir, in continuation of this answer, what you have, your views which you have shared, I also have one more question. How do we see the role of MERUs, that is multidisciplinary education and research universities being set up by the government for handholding these private institutions during this transition phase?
See, Paramarsh as a scheme is not new. It was recommended in the quality mandate of UGC way back, I think 2015-16, it was given for the first time and re-emphasized when COVID started. And again, recently, the chairman UGC has followed up on that letter of 29th March 2020. It's not only these multidisciplinary universities set up by this. In fact, we have been asked to give our option. All the highly graded universities have been given the option of becoming mentor universities. For example, if you are already A plus, the second highest grade, they will assign us some of the universities which will have to mentor and handhold them, help them develop systems and processes, and go for accreditation. Remember, in a country, only about 15 to 16% institutions are accredited. So if you look at accreditation of total, all types of institution taken together, about 50,000, if you look at the list, it's a Herculean task. So all the existing bodies, they may turn into national accreditation coordination kind of bodies, or NAC. And then they will empanel, according to me, in times to come over the next 2-3 years, lots of accreditation bodies from private sector as well as public sector. International accreditation bodies will expand and be present in the country. And we will need the capacity of accreditation bodies to increasingly accredit all. Even though for colleges there has been 15 years time which has been given, but I think we need to move faster, because 2035 means we'll be left with only 5 years for operationalization of, even though the entire decade was marked for operationalization. So I think accreditation will be the key, and this Paramarsh scheme, whether the government identify universities or volunteering. We have a lot of universities that are already A++ and A+ grade, which have been asked for being the mentors. In fact, they have expressed their option, and I'm sure this will happen. So this is a good system. I will appreciate that it should be encouraged more and more, irrespective of government or private. Just to slightly off the track, 2014, when I was heading a university in Haryana, we were called by the principal secretary and directed that you will adopt 5 government colleges around you and mentor them in every aspect. So I think reverse process, we should not hesitate now. Private sector accounts for 70% enrollments. It's going to be there. I think many private sector institutions have done a great job, and then we should involve them into this process.
So probably Rizvi sir wants to say something.
I fully agree with my very learned friend, Professor Raj Singh, on many aspects that he talked about. You see, to me, this entire NEP seems like, at one level, and it seems like a, you know, bell which we need to hang in the neck of the cat. Okay. And we do know that when this bell is hung around the neck of the cat, all of us would be saved. But the million-dollar question in that cat conference which occurred, I mean, sorry, the mice conference that occurred, was who is going to do it and how it is to be done, all right? So it's coming back to the implementation. There are million-dollar questions. Do our universities have the capacity, the large accredited, A+, et cetera, have the necessary capacity, wherewithal, and the competency to mentor institutions? Now, we have seen larger IIMs not being able to mentor the smaller ones. There have been huge issues. Here we're talking about a government university system with due respect to the government.
Yes.
Wherein the curriculum changes take about donkey's ears, you know, wherein a small thing cannot be moved because of the bureaucracy. So that's number one. So there are hiccups, there are major, you know, boulders in front in the way. Number two, you know, there is a million-dollar question about institutions like AIMT, IMIs and other who are standalone private institutions who are doing a tremendously great job, who have been located in cities. Particularly, I would say that we are located in 5.5 acres. We have limited land. We just cannot expand. Okay. Now, in such a situation, if we get affiliated with some university, we will find it very difficult to find an institution of a university of that caliber with whom we would like to affiliate. Now, then what happens 15 years down the line? We cannot introduce courses. So there are, similarly for AIMT, you come out of the clutches, not clutches, of the affiliation with Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University, then you be on your own. How do we go about it with the limited space? There are whole lot of such issues. You know, where is this investment in terms of introducing new courses, et cetera, is going to come from? And it is not a must that they have behemoth in terms of universities. The example of that, member of parliament gave in terms of that university, 900. What are we talking about? Somewhere or the other, we need to come down to certain realistic levels to be able to see what works for us. And that's the reason I still stand by the fact that as Professor Saini was very rightly mentioning, that they have created a task force for the in the university as to how to. Similarly, each institution has to create a task force and see how do we go about it. That's a quick submission of mine. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Pankaj sir wants to say something. Sir, please.
Yes. Okay. I just want to say something that we have seen the great education leader like Dr. Raj Singh, Dr. Rizvi, and many other people. See, they have always worked for other owners kind of organization. I'd like to say, why can't they become the owners? Uh-huh. And you see, creating an organization where the academic leader of their standing, including myself also, who have 20, 30 year experience, have all the idea, but all the time you to look at the owner or Lala ji, kya bhai ye kar le ya na kar le. So my question is that there has to be a mechanism by the well-meaning education leader should be also empowered. And I'm sure that we also have our own brands. Like if we go for crowdfunding, our student whom we have taught in 30 years, they are in all over the world. So if you want to be an entrepreneur, we can also raise money. So some sort of that thinking is needed. Because, chote hi cheez ho, lekin, but we can fulfill all our ideas. Rather than working for other people who have their own interest, ki bhai hamara paisa badh jaye, hamara number of student ho jaye. So that is idea number one. Idea number two is like the way the Infosys was created, where all the people got together, created a great institution, they decided ki sahab leadership aise rotate hogi and everybody will have a share. Why not the faculty members and other people can be given those shares? Aajkal to system hai sahab, you create an education company, you create an infrastructure company. Why not those things? They can also do a great service. And third thing is that, online universities ka model aa sakta hai. So why not to create something like that? And how many of us are also nurturing a dream of creating a unicorn? I remember when I was director of Symbiosis, I mentored and nurtured this Baiju at that time. And now he is into the many, many billions dollar kind of valuation he has got. So all is need is the desire and a passion and entrepreneurial ability. Yeh nahi ho sakta ji, master ji, hum toh yeh hain. Mashelkar ji ka naam Rasar ne liya tha, toh I want to say, unhone bhi kaha hai, you should know how to convert your Saraswati ji into Lakshmi ji. That also is very important. Ki aap apna YouTube channel banao, aap kitabe likho, whatever you do. Like I have been getting multi-crore salary kind of thing I have got. So teacher chahe toh kya nahi hila sakta hai. So I believe that these jo hamare entrepreneurial leaders hain hamare, they should also think to group together and create those centers of excellence rather than thinking about ki some Lala ji will help or some government will help or somebody member of parliament will help. Aapko deepo bhava ki zarurat hai sir. We have to be our own light. That is what I wanted to say. Thank you.
I think Dr. Saab, make a proposal. We are there with you. Just one comment, sir, in terms of shortage of space. I am in the neighborhood of Bangalore here, and they have planned to start a 4-year undergraduate program in humanities, and they've taken another campus adjacent to it because it seems they didn't have the buildings or the space for other programs. Last year, they initiated through a task force, like Dr. Saini said, to diversify and start programs in other areas. Also, you will agree with me that the government, when it comes to the regulation, my strong belief is that they will not insist on contiguous land, piece of land, and they'll permit multiple locations in the same city or in the neighborhood, in fact. And that's, I think, a good enough solution to begin with. We have to wait what kind of provisions government makes. And I think one thing is for sure that NEP, the way it is being planned, government has the willpower and very strongly going ahead with the implementation of this, because that's the way forward. And number two point, see, NEP 2020 did not come out on 29 July 2020. You will agree with me. The examination reforms of November 2019, 2018 November published by AICT, the quality mandate, the choice-based credit system of 2014, aren't they all part of national education policy? In fact, since the time the committee started working, Kasturi Rangan committee, all these regulations and policy guidelines kept coming out, which can be, if accumulated, become national education policies. There's nothing new. Discussions have been going on for the last 5 years, and people have moved ahead, in fact. Thank you.
Very true. I suppose, in fact, Dr. Dinesh Singh, when he was the Vice Chancellor of Delhi University, he proposed the idea of 4-year undergraduate program, of course, which was subsequently shut down. So, yes. I mean, these kinds of ideas have been there, as to everyone understood the reforms needed. Class 10 board examination was made at one level, not compulsory. So that was also there. Now it has been kind of removed. MPhil is not a must anywhere because I never did MPhil, So these are certain things which have been there for quite some time. It's just that for the first time, it has come down as a consolidated document, as Professor Raj very rightly pointed it out.
Seni sir wants to add something to this. Seni sir.
Sir, phir nahi sunai de raha hai aapki baat.
So you have to unmute, sir.
Yeah, Seni sir, you have to.
I was just trying to add to what Dr. Rizvi said, that looking at the CBCS and all these things, they have been actually all these years they've been coming up. But I think even despite that, what we need is a national system which actually can integrate. Like say a university which is offering some courses in Bihar, if somebody wants to transfer his credit to my university in Delhi University, there's no provision in that. I think since NEP, basically, we are getting a structure in place which can allow this kind of movement of credits across the universities. That means there's a complete level playing field, and like say, Delhi University cannot say no to other universities. Likewise, other universities cannot say no to the other universities. So I think this system actually was not in place. Although CBCS was trying to say to be put in place by individual institutions, offering autonomy to the students to offer so choose some courses, but I think to have an integrated framework, basically this is actually the NEP is trying to offer, and this is going to say remove that kind of a discrimination between a university in Bihar, UP, or somewhere else with the university or other university which actually a branded university. I think that basically has become important. Thank you so much, Professor Chawla.
Director sir wants to say something.
Yeah, sir, I had a small submission. Like just now, Dr. Raj Singh spoke about university being, need not be co-located. Yes. It can operate from different locations, as you said, sir.
Yes.
Now, if we look at our Army Welfare Education Society, we have got 12 colleges, which encompass law college, catering and management, nursing, medical, engineering, we have got the full gamut with us.
Right.
So under the NEP, do you think that we have got education also, Army Institute of Education. So suppose under the NEP, we say, we form a complete Army University. Mm. We don't do anything more than that. We have got the students. We have got all the courses running. And we offer everything across the board for any student who wants to join. Mm-hmm. Would that get permissible under this NEP, sir? That is what the thought process.
I can tell you, I'm living this every day. In fact, my 23,000 students and 120 programs are from 10 campuses, out of which 9 are, 8 are in Bangalore city and 1 is slightly above 40 kilometers. And I see the practical difficulties. So I have come up with clusters of adjacent campuses, in fact. And to also tell you that 2 campuses are owned by us, and rest we are more of rented premises, which have taken special permission from UGC. We are a deemed university, by the way, directly governed by UGC. In Uttar Pradesh, the government has given universities permission to operate from 2 campuses that are not at a distance more than 16 kilometers. Now, various state governments are coming up with the distance which is permissible. But I understand all the army institutions, like you are in Greater Noida, your law school in Chandigarh or Tri-City somewhere, and maybe other locations in the country. So a location so far and wide may not make it feasible, because the whole purpose of students interacting, disciplines interacting, informing each other, faculty members teaching in the adjacent campus or another program is the key issue in inter and transdisciplinary education. Physical location will be an issue, but let us wait and see what kind of system the regulatory bodies come out with. The land requirement will be less. And believe me, if 40% is permitted to be delivered online, I think there will be changes in faculty student ratio requirement. How will you sustain otherwise? Because yes. Online, you'll get a degree not more than maybe 30,000-40,000 rupees instead of 2.5-3 lakh rupees, which you charge for full-time programs. Mm-hmm. So all these economics has to be worked out. we have to wait and see. And I'm sure by next year, things should start happening. Like ABC is a reality already. International collaborations, the draft regulations have come in very soon. They should be announced. The speed at which the government is moving, I think we should see some clarity over next 2 to 3 years. But I think this technology is a boon for all of us. This can substitute a lot of things, even though it will take time to become efficient over the next 1 year or so. But I think it's an alternative which needs to be explored and blended with the teaching learning process.
Professor Saini, want to say something?
Yes, Saini, sir.
Yeah, I'm just trying to respond to what Professor Raj Singh said and what actually the question was. I think at present, if you see, the objective of NEP was to bring in multidisciplinarity. That basically was the objective, that students should be able to learn from different streams, interact with each other, and try to become a holistic kind of a knowledge gets developed in the process. So if you talk of campuses which actually are located in different cities and all that, so that purpose actually is not served.
Yes.
And second thing is what Professor Asik said, blended. In fact, although I think maybe even in future time also, we look at even technology cannot help, because we are not looking at purely online universities. Even NEP says blended. So I think there has to be some physical interaction and the online interaction. That's what actually currently is packed at 40%, 60%, that kind of a coverage is there. So they are saying online courses and online mode, both the things actually they are providing in the NEP itself. So I think that so at present, I think this is a limitation. Definitely things will come up in a more clearer manner in the future time to come. But I think one point specifically for AIMT is to that, because if you look at NEP in the long-term implementation, you should try to think of some kind of a other disciplines which you can operate upon, because you have the enough space, which I've seen because I've been to a campus. I think we think of adding some new diversified courses, which actually, because right now you're in the management domain. So if you to transform yourself to a multidisciplinary institution, you need to diversify and add on to some courses. Thank you so much.
I just had a Professor Verma, with your permission, I just have question too. You know, see, when they're talking about the multi-location camp, I mean, a university with multiple locations. Now, here, are we talking about 16-kilometer moratorium that it should not be? Are we talking about interactions among the students or amongst the faculty members? Or is it a question of faculty traveling from one place to the other? Okay, that's something where, yeah, Professor Raj?
Sir, according to me, the interaction is desired for both. Okay. Because unless faculty members interact, they will not develop interdisciplinary perspectives. If you remember, I did mention in my initial talk, the key or a prerequisite to attain higher order learning outcomes, which has been one of the deficiencies in technical terms, we may say it's unemployability or not learning this, whatever way we can say in simple language, but we are not able to attain higher order learning outcomes. And a prerequisite for that is expansion of learning opportunities. Now, how these opportunities could be expanded? Let's say when I, being a student of finance, I talk to somebody from biotechnology. It happened actually with me. When I had to speak to the biotech faculty for the first time coming out of the campus of management, it was like I was shivering, you know, what should I talk to these different creatures who are in front of me? And I came across a faculty who had done a PhD in fly ash technology. And my PhD topic was on strategic cost management, which learns through the processes which can help me optimize the cost, with the life cycle costing, all that. And believe me, we could write a joint research paper on this.
Wow.
I'm just giving an example of this. When design students work with engineering, believe me, the kind of solutions engineering students can come up with the benefit of design thinking is unimaginable, science student, believe me, we have been able to achieve certain objectives where a science student presents the poster through cartoons, where we have done courses like music having impact on the growth of plant, which is taught in biology. We have seen where physics is merged with music, where you are with a dance performance going on at the backside, you're tracing the waves, sound waves, showing that what kind of physics is involved. So through this, what happened, the students start applying the knowledge acquired through their domain into other, the freewheeling develops, interlinkages develop, in fact. So interdisciplinarity is one of the ways of expanding learning outcomes. When you teach through projects instead of classroom teaching, I can give example, if you permit me, 2 minutes, what happened with me, we were absolutely amazed. through this transdisciplinary project, which was my own idea in 2013 and 14, premature idea, I would say. Today, I'm much more clear then, and there's a lot of way to learn for me as I go along, even though we have copyrighted this concept. We gave a project to our students where students came from 8 different departments, schools in the contemporary parlance. And they were to study in Haryana, what is the reason for adverse gender ratio? And you would recall from 2011 census, I think it was 836 girls for 1,000 boys. Mm. It was as bad, the worst in case of Haryana. Mm. And the students got interested, and we told them that in and around Gurgaon, let us study this. So they formed some hypothesis, they formed some questionnaire, and they went beyond Sona. Some of the areas where we could look at even the different religions part of it, from the point of studies, in fact, the culture and religion and the thought process kind of things. 3 villages they covered extensively, and you'll be surprised, against the hypothesis that Haryana is a male-dominated society and Khap Panchayats dictate of what has to be followed in the village, they were shocked and they came to me, that's the women in the family who decide to have a boy and not a girl. That myth was broken. Now, it didn't stop there. I'm telling you the beauty of interdisciplinarity. It has not come yet. Now, what happened when they interacted with these people? That year, if you remember, Haryana government announced the qualifications for local body elections. They said for men, it's 10th class pass for the head of the panchayat and 8th class pass for the members. And for women, it was 8th and 5th class respectively. And sir, there were families who had the headship of village for last 4 or 5 generations. So even though the women in the family became sarpanch, the husband used to run the panchayat. This is how it happens in Haryana. I being from a small village in Haryana, I can vouch for this.
Yeah.
And some of the constraints are reserved for women. When this 30% thing started, women empowerment scheme started. You'll be surprised that not a single woman in the family was eligible to contest elections. And sir, note down, this came in Gurgaon Times as a feature. There were murders in the family. The daughters-in-law were killed to marry the son again to have an eligible daughter-in-law.
Mm-hmm.
The women were divorced, and wherever possible, they married again their son or grandson to have an eligible daughter-in-law, granddaughter-in-law. A purely political issue became a social issue. Now, when my students came, you know, they were having tears in the eyes, and they said, sir, no classroom, no pedagogy can teach this unless we move out of the comfort of the classroom and meet with the people.
Sure.
I'm just giving one example. There's no limit to learning. If any professor from marketing, he'll appreciate me more, sir. There's a concept of core product. When you say MBA, now MBA is a core product. It could be done from anywhere, distance learning, and we have 4,000 or 5,000 institutions. When you say MBA from IMI, you start expecting something that IMI will give me, you know, this. So this is called expected product. When a lot of value addition takes place, for example, I give additional certifications, some skill set, it becomes augmented product, which is again dependent on the institution. But if you go to the last stretch, which can happen through pedagogy and andragogical tools, and that is unlimited, you can keep on stretching outward, that is potential product. And potential product has no limits, sir.
Wow. Yeah. Very nicely articulated. Thank you very much.
Thank you
very much.
Rizvi sir, we have next question for you coming from Principal AIE Dr. Tanya Gupta, ma'am. The question states, how can HEIs adopt the hybrid model of learning, ensuring that learning is more immersive and constructive for students?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Doctor, can I have the name of the person who asked this question?
Dr. Tanya Gupta, Principal AIE, ma'am.
Yeah. Thank you very much for this question, and I'm sure I would look up to other co-panelists to answer. I'll try to. You see, frankly speaking, I am not so much in favor of what you call the blended learning. Let me come out very clearly, okay? It has its own limitations, and in fact, a student who's doing a PhD under me, she is working on this as to comparison in terms of, you know, online learning versus offline learning. Number one. Number two, if the blend online learning or blended learning has to be successful, whether it is off, in fact, there are problems with online, offline learning also. Those who are not interested will never learn. You take them to the class taught by Professor Raj Singh or Professor Saini or Professor Gupta or Professor Chawla, anyone, if they are not interested in learning, you कहते हैं ना कि आप गधे को पानी के पास ले जा सकते हैं, उसको पानी पिलवा नहीं सकते, तो ब्रह्मा भी पढ़ाने को आ जाएंगे, he or she would not learn. So number one, and or online में this becomes or issue becomes all the more compounded. So first and foremost, we have to create in people the will and the desire to learn, as my friend Pankaj Gupta keeps on saying. आपके अंदर वो इच्छा शक्ति, मेरे लिए एकलव्य से बड़ा कोई आज तक हुआ ही नहीं सीखने वाला, ठीक है, हम एकलव्य नहीं बना सकते सबको, बट इफ वी कैन क्रिएट इन देन द डिजायर टू लर्न. अभी क्या है, द ओनर्स ऑफ लर्निंग, एंड एज समवन सेड कालिल जिब्रा, एज टू द ओनर्स ऑफ लर्निंग हैज टू बी ऑन द लर्नर रादर देन द टीचर. अभी खेल अलग है. व्हाई इज दिस लर्निंग सक्सेसफुल इन यूएस एंड यूके एसेट्रा, बिकॉज नंबर वन, the cost of education is very high. Number two, it is paid for by the students themselves. Parent beyond a point don't pay. Okay, हमारे क्या होता है कि बाप माँ बाप जो है अपना गिरवी अपना पेंशन सब कुछ करके उसको पढ़ाते हैं और वो फिर वो धक्का दे करके माँ बाप को निकल जाता है. हमारे यहाँ की विडंबना है. दिस इज सो वी हैव टू क्रिएट दैट वेरी स्ट्रॉन्ग डिजायर इन हिम और हर टू लर्न. एवरी वन शुड नॉट बी गोइंग फॉर हायर एडुकेशन. दैट इज अनदर थिंग विच इज टू बी इम्पॉर्टेंट. सबके बस की बात नहीं है और सबको जरूरत भी नहीं है. इसीलिए दी एनईपी ऑल्सो टॉक्स अबाउट कि आप यहाँ से यहाँ निकल जाइए डिप्लोमा लेके, आप ये कर लीजिए, वोकेशनल कर लीजिए, ये कर लीजिए. हायर एडुकेशन में छठे हुए लोग आने चाहिए जिनका कि कमिटमेंट है, जो कि कुछ करना चाहते हैं. और जब वो हम ऐसी छटनी करेंगे और जब ऐसे लोग आएंगे, उनके लिए सारे एकलव्य की मात्रा उनके अंदर बढ़ जाएगी, तो वो अपने आप सीख लेंगे. हमको क्लासेस को इंटरेस्टिंग बनाना होगा, क्लोजर टू द लर्नर बनाना होगा, सो दैट उसको उसमें कुछ हासिल होता नजर आए. वन साइडेड लेक्चर नहीं होने चाहिए, थोड़ा सा क्यूरियोसिटी, डिस्कवरी ऑफ वे ऑफ लर्निंग, एक्सपीरियंशियल लर्निंग. तो हमारी पेडागॉजी और एंड्रोगॉजी जो है, इसमें जब तक बदलाव नहीं आएगा, ये लर्निंग ब्लेंडेड लर्निंग हो, ऑफलाइन हो, ऑनलाइन में जमाने भर मैंने पढ़ाया है ऑफलाइन, तो मैंने वो भी देखा है और सारे लोगों ने देखा, ये तो अभी 1.5 साल का मामला है. सो ऑल ऑफ अस नो इट. सो क्रिएट दैट डिजायर, तो मैं फिर उसके बाद मैजिक अपने आप होता है. आई विल पास इट ऑन टू प्रोफेसर सैनी एंड प्रोफेसर राज टू ऐड ऑन.
सर, जस्ट वन एनेक्डोटल काइंड ऑफ थिंग आई विल इनपुट, अदरवाइज आई विल लाइक टू लिसन टू डॉक्टर सैनी मोर देन एनीबडी एल्स. आई हैड द अपॉर्चुनिटी ऑफ इंटरेक्टिंग विद द फाउंडर्स ऑफ कोर्सेरा इन द ईयर 2013. And you would recall Coursera started in 2011 with Daphne Koller and Andrew Ng uploading their courses in Stanford. So we're interacting with the Daphne Koller. And this was a vice chancellor's meet in Gurgaon. And one of the vice chancellors said that, madam, don't you feel that online or e-learning cannot replace face-to-face teaching? And you know, Rijvisa, what she said, she said, professor, the distance learning starts from the second row in the classroom. and it made so much of sense to me. So I think it boils down to how do we engage students? It's online or offline, immaterial. I am a strong advocate of blended learning because there are certain types of teaching learning. There's a theory lectures where very basic kind of theory, they can be substituted by online lectures, definitely. And the time you save, I think, should be devoted towards more engaging activities, group activities. The example I cited to you, it can lead to phenomenal learning. So I think that way I'm slightly optimistic that blended learning is the way forward. Also, sir, blended learning will help us. Let's say you want to teach a course, but you can't teach because you don't have a professor, or you can't afford to appoint a professor just for one module. I think online learning is the best way forward. One of the former AICT vice chairman told me, he studied in US, that wherever you don't have professor or you have less number, he said the best way I learned was a book review method. They said, we were 7 of us, professor called us on day one. He called us thrice in the semester. He said, pick up the best book from library, present a book review. In between, he met us. He suggested some more research by this. And lastly, he evaluated us. And he said, I learned maximum from that course. So I think we as teachers, whether in B.Ed. or any other discipline, we need to think out of the box. And one last point, if you can reform examinations in a country, believe me, it will push you to be innovative in teaching learning process. Examination is not only to give marks or label the students with a grade. I think examination system authenticates, judges, the relevance of curriculum or any interventions you make, the efficacy and efficiency of this. And then ultimately puts a label on the students and gives a lot of feedback into the system. The weakest link in the Indian system, sir, is evaluation. We have made a mockery of in the history.
Excellent. Sir, ek bas quick, very quick comment. Main kai baar ye mehsoos karta hoon, aapne bhi kaha, you said also, ki majboori ka naam online learning. Jab aapke paas teacher nahi hai, jab aapke paas ye nahi hai, wo nahi hai, to aap isko resort kar sakte hain.
Absolutely.
I'm fully with you on this. But Professor Saini.
Yes, I think I fully agree with the, and endorse what Professor Raj Singh said, that I am also a strong advocate of that blended learning, because we have seen over the year the traditional way we have been teaching the blackboards and all that, engaging the students and all that. But I think the online mode of delivery also has certain advantages in terms of reaching those students, or maybe say, but one of them, of course, you mentioned about the resource crunch. Like, say, if you have shortage of faculty or because of the non-availability of some faculty members, you are not able to deliver a course. I think these are the limitation factors which actually are overcome by what you call as online mechanism also. Apart from that, I think if you see that you have mechanisms to track and improve the engagement of the students also, especially in those activities where students actually have to do the field work, or maybe say even what he mentioned about the book review. In fact, I am personally using the article review in my courses, which actually I teach. Because if you ask the students to read literature review, bring out some articles, do the review, and try to bring their own critical inputs. I think these are some of the ways we can always, because one thing which is there, which is actually in favor of what we call as the traditional mode of teaching, is the personalization. Definitely, it has huge advantages because the contact between the student and the teacher, even the face-to-face learning and expressions, I think that basically is a good assessor. But I think I fully endorse the second point which Professor Raj Singh made, is that the assessment part. In fact, let me share with you that our Vice Chancellor has been very, very, he's clearly said that we must try to evolve a continuous system of rather than depending on what's the cramming and then reproducing into the reservation system. Try to have that kind of a system where you continuously assess the students. So that would serve two purposes. One, of course, is to reduce the dependence on the end term examination, which actually is always looked upon by the students as a. Secondly, it will also provide a kind of a continuous review, that means what students are learning. And in between, you can take a corrective measure also. So if you find some students actually are lacking something, you can take a corrective input and try to give a feedback and try to improve. So that basically we are trying to incorporate. I'm just sharing with you, we are trying to incorporate that maybe in the subsequent scheme which you come up with. So maybe in the time to come, we'll have lesser weightage for the end term examination, which we say per se, because the ordinance says, again, we have to modify that. Otherwise, we have to try to work on that direction also. Thank you so much.
Sir, before we switch on to ek last statement, ek statement hi hai, aur kuch nahi bolunga main, is that somewhere or the other, you know, for school education, we have B.Ed, wherein the teachers are taught how to teach. When it comes down to higher education, unfortunately, we have absolutely, absolutely nothing. हमारे जैसे गधे आके पढ़ाने खड़े हो जाते हैं ठीक है तो ऐसे में आई थिंक इट्स वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट एंड आई थिंक देयर आर सीनियर पीपल लाइक प्रोफेसर राज सही साहब अदर्स दैट वी नीड टू हैव अ सॉलिड पंकज हिमसेल्फ इज अ ग्रेट टीचर कि हमको चाहिए एक ऐसा प्रोग्राम जिसमें कि हम हायर एजुकेशन के लोगों को जो इन्वॉल्व हैं टीचिंग में उनको पढ़ा सकें कि भाई आपको कैसे पढ़ाना है व्हाट इज एन एंगेज्ड टीचिंग लर्निंग प्रोसेस आई थिंक देयर इज अ ह्यूज लैक्यूना ओवर देयर रिसर्च के लिए तो बहुत सारे सेमिनार होते हैं कि हाउ टू पब्लिश इन इंटरनेशनल जर्नल्स इज दैट एंड द अदर और SEM और वगैरह इसके लिए हम कुछ नहीं कर रहे हैं जबकि ये है ब्रेड एंड बटर सम एंड सब्सटेंस ऑफ एन एकेडमिक इंस्टीट्यूशन दैट्स व्हाट आई वांटेड टू सबमिट यस सर पंकज सर
रिजवी साहब आई जस्ट वांट टू से वन थिंग जो मैं बोलने जा रहा था आपने बिल्कुल बोल दिया यू नो इन बीएड व्हाट हैपेंस यू नो दे विल टेल फर्स्ट 10 मिनट्स में क्या करना है फिर क्या करना है And, you know, I have been using that technique in my classes, you know, like I create like 5 to 7 minute kind of interval thing. Ki pehle ye, you know, somebody will talk about what did we learn, you know, yesterday's class or wherever it was. Then what is the implication for me? Then sharing of some new knowledge out of that discussion. Then, you know, some discussion, then a small video film. Then after that, the reflection. So all the time it is very reflective. And also how you give that freedom to the student to control the class, you know, where you are talking less and more discussion and viewpoints are exchanged. And then you see, wow, something even new has been created. And also something new created, which even you did not anticipate when you started the class.
Exactly.
So that kind of excitement is very, very important. And then we also say that you also write a reflective note, which I learned in IIM Ahmedabad, that, you know, what is your key learning of today? Why did this learning happen? And what was your contribution in that learning? So if you just take that as an assessment model, so you can see the mirror, and also you create an online platform where students are sharing their reflection. So in that way, everybody is learning from each one's experience. And then I also help my student engaging in small video films. Like if I teach management of self in the organization, or if there is a harassment situation at workplace, how to handle it. So people will create their own video film, they will put it in the YouTube, and then you'll see how many likes are there, how much impact is there. So in this way, you have the freedom to keep on creating the new models of assessment. And especially in OP Jindal University, we have got enormous freedom to decide whatever we want to do. That was the reason when I was leaving my job as a vice chancellor, I was getting many jobs as a VC. But I thought to come back to OP Jindal because it is a great university, a lot of, you know, great colleagues are there. So I believe, you know, the teacher, one of my mentors used to say that teacher is the hero or heroine of the class. So it is your responsibility, like the way you want that your son and daughter have to be taught in a very love and compassionate manner. When a guru upar se chot laga raha, andar se haath rakha hua hai. So if you have that being of a guru, to har cheez apne aap hoti hai, sir. I feel that sometimes you will go in a class with a different mode, puri planning karke, but you see that certain other dimension is start happening. So if you go with that mode, to sab cheez apne aap hota hai. And also then you are also able to create a lot of other new material which you can post in your YouTube site. You can create your own material. So, ye cheez hai, sir. I just thought to share this.
Thank you. Parma sahab, take over.
Just one line I wanted to add what Dr. Izvi said. I think for higher education, we do not need the teachers actually. We say mentors. In fact, mentors are the one who actually, are trying to basically take the students to what we call as the river. But after that, how much to go deep into that is dependent on the student. Every student may not say dive too deep. So it is basically to take them to the river and try to tell them this, how basically what all you can do with it. So basically we need mentors rather than teachers as such in the higher education.
Really?
This is what my belief.
I fully agree. Paucity of time. I will sit here.
Right.
Right.
I also wanted to say that WhatsApp groups are also great way. They
don't read. They don't read this history. They don't read classics. They don't read. अरे जब आप पढ़ोगे नहीं तो पढ़ाओगे कैसे सर? तो जो mentoring और teaching का है, इसे बहुत बड़ा question है. I'm with you, sir. But over to
sir. Here I'll just like to add. Actually, the NEP Article 15.9. It says that all fresh PhD entrants, irrespective of the discipline, will be required to take credit-based courses in teaching, education, pedagogy, writing related to their chosen PhD subject. Absolutely. During their doctoral training period. They will also have minimum number of hours of actual teaching experience gathered through teaching assistantship and other means. So actually, NEP is also catering to how they have to learn to teach. So that is also one of the aspects which has been covered in it.
Wonderful. Thank you very much. Thank you, Saulo sir, for bringing it to
sir, Pankaj sir, question to you, taking the cue from what director sir had said. This NEP is again trying to revive the concept of Gurukul education, which was there in India. You had also talked about ancient wisdom. So how do you see that kind of freedom, that kind of learning environment and holistic development? Is NEP envisaging that, and will we be able to achieve that in due course of time with this multidisciplinary approach? Second part to this is ki, to what extent are we able to make our students accept the failures? We do talk about success. What about the failures? The culture of failure has to be accepted. So, sir, to you.
आपने बड़ा खतरनाक सवाल पूछ लिया, but nonetheless, I'll try to reply to this. See, the question is the real way of education, where how the guru was called the guru, somebody who can remove the darkness. So, guru tha nera, and guru was, you know, to remove that. So, and Shishata ki, when everything is lost, then what is Shesh? That is called as a Shishya. Aur Bharat kya tha? Bhav Rat. Bhav matlab Prakash, aur Rat matlab uski or. To Prakash ki or le jaye. Aur usme jo sabse bada role tha, that was of the Guru. But unfortunately, those kind of Gurus are less, who can forget themselves for the sake of, you know, developing their Shishya. और उस तरह के शिष्य भी नहीं रहे, बिकॉज हर एक शिष्य भी अलग अलग मोड से आता है. Somebody come, let me get a degree, मेरी शादी अच्छी हो जाएगी. Somebody will say, मेरे को इतना नौकरी मिल जाएगा. Somebody will say, I will get a better, you know, migrating to the Canada, चला जाऊंगा या चली जाऊंगी. So the whole thing is, you know, in a different muddled manner at the moment. But what I feel, and sometimes based on the brand of the institution, we know that how much is the average GMAT, average CAT, kind of average math student you are able to get. But question is that agar hum guru hain to hamare paas jo bhi aa jaye bachcha, pehli cheez to usko pure prem se hame accept karna chahiye. And I believe, you know, one of the success, you know, people say Pankaj you have got great connection and all that. I have done nothing. Jo mere samne aaya kaam, maine usko puri imandari puri shiddat se kiya. And you know, the moment I do that work in perfection, naturally the next level of growth comes searching for me. So I believe that, you know, whatever student we get, we have to be with total being with them. And also, you know, not only one faculty can do something or one director can do something. It has to be a cluster of gurus. And who can see that what are the primary goals we talk about, graduate outcomes. And also some people may be having a lot of seed for, you know, being an entrepreneur. Somebody in a different kind of possibilities are there. So I say this. If you're like an apple seed, even better you get planted in Kashmir. If you're a coconut seed, better go to Kerala and like that. So guru ko pehle dekhna hoga ki us bacche mein kya potential hai, and then, you know, nurturing it like their own son and daughter. Aur uska IDP bana ke, individual development plan bana karke, nurturing it over a period of time, and then you will see that all the things will be falling in place. And so I believe that in the current time, you can in this way inspire and transform very less number of people if you follow only that model. But at the same time, with the technology platform available, you can also impact a larger set of people. Like, you know, the Army institution, they have so many colleges. Maybe a centralized way of mentoring and coaching can be created. And also not only the guru, but also you can talk about your alumnus. And alumnus, I created a 3-tier mentorship model, where you have a CEO level mentor, then vice president level mentor, then, you know, the assistant manager level mentor. And also what mentoring is and what mentoring is not, what is mentoring and what is reverse mentoring, all these have to be defined. Otherwise, somebody will say, apni war story suna rahe hain, gyan suna rahe hain, bachcha interested nahi aaj ki date mein. So empathetic learning, being there for them and not giving too much of gyan. Because if you feel that you are going to give the gyan, then that means you are also restricting the future generation. You know, if you give too much of gyan, then it is not the right thing of a guru. It is simply the gyan which is already there in that child. You have to simply unfold that. So in this way, we shall be able to create better human beings and, you know, more responsible citizens, and motivating them to know who they are. You know, by lot of experiential activity, like what Dr. Raj Singh was sharing, ki jo theory subject hai, theek hai, unka aapne recorded kar liya, usko aap chalao, time bachao usse. And the thing which are practical, aap 5-5 bachon ke group banao, usko nurture karo. So guru knows what has to be done, but that role has to be lived perfectly and without thinking about ki mere ko kya milega. Question ye ki a work done well is a reward in itself. जो तुलसीदास कहते हैं ना, स्वांताय सुखाय, कि मैं अपनी खुद की खुशी के लिए काम कर रहा हूं. यू नो, समबडी हु कंप्लीट द वर्क ऑन देयर ओन एंड विदाउट द नीड ऑफ एनी सुपरविजन. तो वी नीड टू हैव दोस काइंड ऑफ लविंग एंड सेल्फ अवेयर गुरुज, एंड देन यू विल सी द शिष्य ऑल्सो स्टार्ट रिस्पॉन्डिंग टू यू. लेट मी टेल यू दैट इन माई यूनिवर्सिटी ऑल्सो देर आर स्टूडेंट हु विल नॉट ओपन देयर कैमराज इन माई ऑनलाइन क्लास, लेकिन मेरी क्लास में सब खोल के बैठते हैं. So it also depends ki aap unko kaisa comfort level dete ho, or matlab how you handle your job. I think that make a very important thing, and guru shishya parampara is very important, aur hum log usko bilkul, we should feel proud of it. बल्कि मैं लास्ट एक चीज ये कहना चाहूंगा, जो मैकॉले ये सब जो आए ना, दे हैव ब्रोकन अवर कॉन्फिडेंस एक्चुअली, कि भाई तुम गुड, यू आर नॉट गुड एनफ. हमें खाली उसी कॉन्फिडेंस को दोबारा रिगेन करना है. दैट्स इट. द मोमेंट वी नो हु वी आर अनस्टॉपेबल, ये सब अमेरिका चाइना सब दो मिनट में भाग जाएंगे. दैट्स इट.
सबको मिलना चाहिए एक्सेसिबिलिटी, अफोर्डेबिलिटी, क्वालिटी, सारी कुछ. देर इज अः वी आर मूविंग टूवर्ड्स मास एडुकेशन. गुरुकुल जो हमारा था वो सिर्फ क्लास एडुकेशन था, वो कस्टमाइज था. ओके, कस्टमाइज में जब होता है कुछ बच्चे रहते हैं तो आपका पर्सनल अटेंशन हो सकता है, लेकिन जब मास एडुकेशन होता है उसमें पर्टिकुलरली आप ब्लेंडिंग भी, ब्लेंडेड भी जोड़ दीजिए, तो बहुत सारे कॉम्प्लिकेशंस हो सकते हैं. सो आई थिंक वी कैन नॉट कंपेयर एप्पल्स विद ऑरेंजेस बिकॉज देर आर टू डिफरेंट एरास. नंबर वन सबमिशन. ओके, इट्स जस्ट नॉट पॉसिबल बिकॉज दैट क्लास इज जस्ट नॉट पॉसिबल. ओके, नंबर वन. नंबर टू, बट आई फुली अग्री विथ द फैक्ट कि हर एक बच्चा विद, अभी क्या है, द सेम एडुकेशन सिस्टम, मास एडुकेशन इन यूएस, यूके, इट्स वेरी सक्सेसफुल. वहां पर जो क्वालिटी निकलती है, जो कि हम हार्वर्ड और ऑक्सफोर्ड की बात करते हैं, कैम्ब्रिज की बात करते हैं, हमारे इंडिया में अभी वो सारे इंस्टीट्यूशंस बहुत सारे कम हैं. इट्स नॉट दैट हमारे देर इज अ डर्थ ऑफ क्वालिटी टीचर्स और एक्स वाई जी. आई थिंक देर इज दिस एंटायर इको सिस्टम विच हैज टू बी लुक्ड इन टू. नो लास्ट पीस वेरी क्विकली. Well, someone like my dear friend, Professor Pankaj Gupta, who has been the vice chancellor, who has mentored this, that, he has arrived. Now he can do things for his pleasure. But someone who is starting his career, okay, who has just graduated, mere ko abhi, I have to pay up my loan for education, I have to do this, I have to build up my, you know, financial stability, this, that, and the other. Now for him or her, there are so many balls he or she is juggling in the air that it becomes a little difficult to become the real ideal. That, but that does not mean that ideal should not be in our sight, we should not try to achieve. Okay, I just thought that, you know, at one level there is this ideal thing and there is this practical. Ek to humko manna padega, somewhere or the other, particularly with the school teachers and other teachers, we have to make their life little more comfortable. थोड़ा उनको पैसा दे दें, थोड़ा उनसे ये उम्मीद मत करें कि वो इलेक्शन ड्यूटी पे भी जाए और उसके बाद उसको कोविड भी हो जाए तो कोई पूछे नहीं. प्लीज वो उसको हर जगह मत फूसिए, उसको पढ़ाने दीजिए, सरस्वती का साधक है, उसको करने दीजिए, वो अच्छा काम करेगा. अब ये है कि पैसे बचाने के चक्कर में अब मैं क्या बोलूँ सर, क्षमा जी. नेक्स्ट.
साहब, आपकी बात से मैं सहमत हूँ. आई फुली एग्री विद यू. बट हर चीज संभव है. मतलब द मोमेंट, बिकॉज द कंस्टेंट्स आर ओनली इन द माइंड, आई मस्ट से दैट. एंड आई, यू नो, कीप एक्सपेरिमेंटिंग. यू नो, दिस न्यू लुक इज ऑल्सो वन ऑफ द दैट ग्रेट बोल्ड स्टेप आई हैव टेकन. लाइक 22 ईयर्स आई हैव बीन कीपिंग द फ्रेंच बियर्ड. तो वंस दिस टाइम आई वेंट टू द हिमालयस, आई फाउंड हु एम आई. देन आई केम आउट कि अरे ये तो पूरा मेरे सारे वीडियो, मीडिया इंटरव्यू, दुनिया भर की सब चीजें, इट इज ओनली ऑन द बियर्ड. So then I decided to remove it. शुरू अजीब सा लगा, but then it is fine. Now many people are saying कि अरे भाई तुम बहुत better लग रहे हो. So unless you jump, how will you know? और दूसरी बात है कि EMI सर, एक छोटी सी बात, EMI वगैरह ऐसा बंधन में नहीं बनना चाहिए. At the moment you are financially free, क्योंकि दूसरों के लिए नहीं जीना चाहिए कि भाई मेरे पास बड़ा घर है, दिखाने को ये है. अपनी जो फ्रीडम है अगर वो मेंटेन है, then you can do whatever you want to do, sir.
सर, भूखे भजन न होए गोपाला, समझो. जब पेट में नहीं है, जब मेरे पास वो नहीं है और इसी दुनिया में रहना है, इसी सोसाइटी में रहना है. बच्चे बोलते हैं कि सर आप क्या स्कूटर पे चल रहे हो, उनके पास देखो, वर्मा साहब के पास तो बड़ी सी गाड़ी है. यू नो, आप, यू, वी आर अ सोशल एंटिटी. टीचर जो है कोई आसमान से नहीं आया. और यहाँ तक गुरुकुल, आप देखिए, हमारी जो सांस्कृतिक धरोहर है, क्लासिकल म्यूजिक, वो जो है एक यूनिवर्सिटी डिपार्टमेंट पढ़ाई जाती है और इंडिविजुअल टीचर के साथ. जमीन आसमान का जो खानदानी तरीका रहा है, जो घराने हैं, जमीन आसमान का फर्क है. ओवर टू यू वर्मा साहब.
सो वी विल टेक ऑन द लास्ट क्वेश्चन व्हिच इज फ्रॉम मोहंती सर फॉर सैनी सर. So Monty sir wants to ask you ki whether university will allow affiliated institutes like AIMT to be part of this NEP task force to design multidisciplinary courses.
See, as such, because university, as I think you know that we have about 120 plus colleges under the university, it's not possible to involve, because otherwise this becomes a too big a large task force or maybe people to handle and take inputs. So what we have done is we have appointed a coordinator from one of the affiliate colleges. He basically coordinates with other colleges to arrive at something. But definitely when we formulate something as a draft document, we share with all the directors. So that at least we can invite all those inputs as well. So maybe you can send your inputs through either to the either directly to the dean also, or maybe to the program coordinator of the BB and MB program also. So that basically mechanism, because it's not possible to say involve everybody, 100 plus people, and try to take inputs. So we are trying to work out this way that we have a close body which try to work upon it. But definitely your inputs are valuable to us, and we try to invite through an open system, to the kind of suggestion like UDC is trying to do, whenever there be document they put in the public domain and try to invite suggestions. The same thing we try to do that. But definitely you are welcome to submit any suggestions or any idea which you have to start the multidisciplinary things and all that. That's more.
Thank you so much, sir. We have got over the time, but the kind of discussion which we had been really engrossing, very enriching for us. At least for me, it is going to be there for next 2, 3, 4 years to think about, like what sir had clearly brought out, self-awareness, self-realization, to and to identify who am I. Then only I can be more productive.
Yeah, but I won't send you to the Himalayas, okay? I won't send you to the Himalayas. You are required here for teaching.
Before you close up, ek cheez main, I just forgot. Dekhiye, antato gatva jo kehte hai na, final analysis, what is the purpose of education? I'm just proposing it, and you can reject it, but don't reject it very quickly. Just ponder over it, and then is that the greatest thing that a teacher, as an educator, as a teaching learning, we can provide to the students is provide them this ability to think. The moment that they develop this ability to think, they will be able to acquire the ability to solve problems. So that's number one, what we need to teach people, how to think. Aur jo ek baar thinker ban gaya, wo apne usne zindagi bhar ke liye usko, you have taught him how to fish. Number two, jo chahiye zaruri hai, jisko Pankaj kai baar emphasize kar chuke hain, ki sensitivity, self-confidence, empathy. Ye dusri cheez hai, attitude develop karna. Aur teesri cheez hai, ki we have to become a global citizen, जिसमें कि diversity को हम embrace करें, tolerate नहीं करें. अगर हमने ये तीन चीजें अपने बच्चों को दे दी, तो सर ये बल्ले बल्ले है. We have succeeded, we have done what we have here for. सोचने की शक्ति, उनको खुद सवाल, उनके सवाल मत करिए, उनको सोचने दीजिए. I personally feel if we do this, our job is done. Thank you very much. I didn't want to have the last word. This is not the last word. Please take over.
Thank you so much, Rizvi sir. Thank you so much. Wonderful thoughts. Over to you, Rahul sir, now.
Thank you, Anubhav sir. And it was such a nice learning session for all of us, even though from the traditional Gurukul system to the modern tag-based learning. So now I invite our director, sir, Commodore Dr. Vivek Chawla, for the felicitation of guests. So to start with, Dr. Susmit Patra, thank you so much, sir.
Thank you very much, Dr. Susmit Patra. Though you're not here, we will convey our best wishes to you. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
To Dr. Raj Singh, sir, thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. Dr. Raj Singh, sir, we have learned a lot from you, and we hope to carry this forward, sir. Thank you very much, sir, for spending your valuable time, sir.
Calling me, sir. Thank you. Absolutely fantastic.
Thank you, Dr. Anil Kumar Saini, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Saini, sir. Thank you so much for being with us today and also being part of our ACAC, sir. We really treasure and value your suggestions, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, Dr. Pankaj Gupta, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. Dr. Pankaj Gupta, sir. We have a lot to learn from you. And in fact, we would like to invite you also for some of our guest lectures, because I think all this about the Sanskrit and the Bhavs and everything was very, very impressive, sir. And we have a lot to learn from you, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Irfan Rizvi, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Rizvi, sir. We have learned a lot from you and we have gained a lot from you all these years as being a member of our ACAC and the valuable contributions you have made, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Right. Thank you. Now, so all good things comes to an end. So here our webinar also. So now I would request our academic head, Dr. Anubhav Verma, to propose vote of thanks.
Thank you again, Rahul, sir. What a wonderful session. Great learning. On behalf of AIMT Greater Noida, I would first like to thank our chairman, Major General Alok Kakkar, Chief of Staff, Delhi Area, and Chairman AIMT for his continuous support. I would also like to thank Dr. Sasmit Patra, Member of Parliament, to have accepted our invite at such a short notice, although he is not with us right now, but good to have him here. I would like to thank our Honorable Chief Guest, Dr. Raj Singh, sir, for sparing his valuable time and gracing the occasion with his presence and inspiring words on alignment of state universities to the national curriculum. I would thank Dr. Saini, sir, Dean, University School of Management Studies, GDSIPU, for giving us insights how universities planning for introduction of new management courses and how can AIMT get insights into it. I would thank Pankaj Gupta, sir, Dean OP Jindal Global University, for providing insights into importance of self-awareness and which are being incorporated and which have to be incorporated in the curriculum to make students not only industry ready, but to make them ready to take on life challenges. I thank Rizvi sir for providing his valuable views on the way ahead for AIMT. Thank you so much, sir, for your undeterred support and continuous guidance to AIMT. Thank you, sir. I take this opportunity to thank Brigadier Naveen Goel, sir, BGS Delhi Area and Assistant Chairman AIMT for his insightful views. I would thank Colonel Bhatti, Director AWES, and Colonel Vivek Jala, SO Colleges Delhi Area, for sparing their valuable time. I express my gratitude to all respected dignitaries from various Army professional colleges under Western Command who have joined us today and have been part of this deliberation. I wish to extend my heartfelt thanks to our director, Commodore Dr. Vivek Chawla, for his support, Registrar Sir, my faculty colleagues, students, and the support staff for their enduring support. In the end, last but not the least, a special thanks to our CTPO, Arshia Ismail Ma'am, Mohanty Sir, Professor Rahul Verma, our student coordinators, Nikita, Pankaj, and Ravinder, who have worked round the clock to make this event happen. Finally, I would like to say, Gurur Brahma, Gurur Vishnu, Gurur Devo Maheshwara, Guru Sakshat Par Brahma Tasmin Shri Gurve Nama. Hence, the responsibility for successful implementation of this new education policy lies also on the shoulders of academic fraternity along with our government and management. Thanks. Stay safe. Jai Hind.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you to all of you.
Thank you. Namaskar.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for being part of the webinar, sir.
Pleasure. Pleasure, sir. Take care.